Thanks for listening to the Von Haessler Doctrine Podcast. Remember, you can hear the show every weekday from 9 to noon right here on 95.5 WSB, Atlanta's news and talk. Live from Sherwood Forest in the heart of Atlanta, Georgia, hour one of the Von Haessler Doctrine begins right now. I am your lovable, huggable, mid-morning chat host, Eric Von Haessler, surrounded by the lovable Doctrinaires, man of a thousand voices, Tim Andrews, lady of quite a few voices in her own right, Autumn Fisher, and of course the handsomest producer in all of producery, Jared Yamamoto.
And I'm not springing forward this weekend, Eric. I refuse to spring forward.
Hashtag resistance.
I am resisting.
Nevertheless, she's going to resist.
And we're going to persist because you're going to force yourself. You'll be, what are you, going to live on the wrong time for a few months now?
I'm going to live on my time.
You're sticking.
Daylight savings time forever.
So daylight savings time. What are we? Why am I? So we lose an hour, right?
Correct. We spring forward, right?
Why am I getting this? This should be easy. In my brain, I must be thinking it's fall because I keep thinking that we're going to fall back, but of course we're not. It's we're springing forward.
Yeah.
For heaven's sakes, Von Haessler. You know this.
Yeah.
It's March.
You know.
I'm getting the Joe Biden disease.
You know the thing.
I know the thing. The thing. So we spring forward, and we lose an hour.
Yeah.
And you're not willing to lose that hour.
I'm not doing it. I resist it.
You know what? I once misplaced an hour. For like weeks, and then I found it. It was kind of cool. It's like, hey, what happened to that $100 bill? Right? Bothers you. But then 3 weeks later, when you find it in the laundry, it's like a special surprise.
Oh, I didn't know I had this.
I got that hour back like a month later. It was fantastic.
What'd you do with it?
I think I had a beer on the porch.
Nice.
So I was ready to turned up some good Southern rock and blasted out. But I had sometimes, this guy told you this yesterday, I'm like a squirrel with the time.
Yeah.
And my time nuts. I gather them. I gather my time nuts, and I put them away, and then bring them back out. They're like rollover minutes.
Right.
Yeah, you could do that with the time. My question with you is, does that mean you will get to work an hour early every day or an hour late every day?
The world will adjust to me, Eric.
Yeah,
it's my world.
I forgot. You're a millennial. You're right. Let's do this.
Headlines for Friday, March 6th.
The entire universe shall bend toward me.
Yeah.
And me and my needs.
With my body clock. My body clock's going to be all messed up.
Circadian rhythm.
Your circadian rhythms. Remember the circadian rhythms?
I do.
Fantastic.
78.
Yeah, acapella.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Acapella punk band.
Harmony. Yeah, no one has heard punk harmonies like before or since, actually. Before we get going, of course, as you know, we're still under a bit. We're in the middle of the threat here, and I have the sanitation crew standing by. I think we sanitize the studio for the coronavirus before we get going, just to be safe, all right? So everybody
this is better than having
it's good. Yeah. They say it's good for you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Might
not want to bring it.
Oh, man.
I see anybody. Alan, no huffing. No, Alan's huffing things.
Hey, my lips purple?
He's huffing. He's huffing the computer cleaner. No, that's not a good idea.
I'm dusting.
Dusting your brain. That's not a good idea. And I realized with the coronavirus, I've been doing some things right and some things wrong. For one thing, I think that we've been doing right, and I don't care. I'll take the criticism. First time in modern history in the media where somebody says, don't panic, and they're considered irresponsible. But I've been doing everything I can. Wash your hands. I wash my hands more. And I'm trying like crazy not to touch my face. And I'm doing, we're all working through that one. None of us realized how much we touch our faces until we're told
not to touch our faces. But what I didn't realize is not only am I supposed to stop touching my face, but what I didn't know is that I'm supposed to stop touching Jared's face as well, which I just simply
how could you not?
It's a very baby. I'm a face toucher. People know this. Some people are huggers. I'm a face toucher.
You're just gonna have to resist for a few more months until
it's very, very difficult. What are we working together? 5 years?
Yeah.
Your face is like my Blarney Stone. You know, without touching your face, I don't know that I could have good luck. Let's have a good show.
Touch from Jared's face.
Yeah. We all gather around the Doctrinaires. Before every show, people don't know this because we're transparent, but we don't tell you everything. You know, Madonna has the huddle before the show. We have a bit of a huddle of our own, and I talk people up, and then all the Doctrinaires touch Jared's face, and we break. And I didn't realize that. I thought you could touch another man's face, but no faces.
Nope. So I'm basically like the four-leaf clover of the Doctrine,
absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely. Don't lie. That's exactly what you are. You know what the Blarney Stone? Blarney Stone. I'm getting that right? You rub the Blarney Stone.
Kiss the Blarney Stone.
Oh, you kiss.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, hey, look.
There's a different stone over there.
I'm a face toucher. I'm a face toucher. I'm not a face kisser. I think that's gross. Men, women, anything.
Yeah, well, you spread viruses that way.
Apparently, I'm done. I'm done touching. You know, Microsoft, a lot of companies are pulling out of South by Southwest, and then all these companies are, we had one, you read it the other day, the Cox, CMG, whatever we work for.
Yeah, basically it's that washer.
I forget which company we still work for.
Cox
CMG. They put out a thing, protocols to
not spread
the virus.
Yeah, just basically wash your hands. If you're feeling sick, stay at home.
So I heard that Microsoft said, well, we're not going to close our places down, but their protocol with their employees is always stay 6 feet apart.
Mm.
Now, do they know they even have the square footage for that? Well,
they're all in cubicles. How could you do that?
Yeah, I mean, 6 feet apart. Don't deal with each other. Now, I had heard that it was 3 feet was enough long ago for my father-in-law. Rest
just
in peace.
Just the flu.
It's the flu. He's 3 feet apart, and basically you're okay. As long as you're not touching Jared's face, which is the new piece of information that I didn't have. All right, what's going on with Corona? I have an article here, by the way. Good article from MSN. What is that online even? Microsoft Nation?
Microsoft News?
News, I guess, but they're not MSNBC anymore, right? They're not connected. MSNBC, before it was all political, was a technology station. It was Microsoft and NBC got together. Mm-hmm. And then when they turned and became like the anti-Fox News, it was still Microsoft until a couple years ago, Microsoft totally pulled out. So MSN, this is then, in fact, Microsoft News.
Must be.
This is like Bill Gates' version of the Drudge Report. Is this the Gates Report?
The Gates Report, yes.
So, there's an article. I won't start with this. Although I will tell you, in my experience, one of the greatest pleasures and joys in the world is listening to a radio host read from a news article. But I'll put that off a little bit. But interesting, a coronavirus danger, it says, touching your face. Here is how to stop doing it. And I read this entire article. It's a lot of great background on why we touch our faces so much. We're beginning to realize that we touch our... Haven't you? Just knowing...
I just scratched my chin right here.
You know,
I touched my face.
Apparently, they just did some studies on medical students, right? In a class. And they touched their faces 23 times in an hour. We have no idea how many times. But it turns out they've done studies on face touching. And it appears to be connected to when we feel like we're not doing things exactly right. It's a protective kind of thing, kind of a negative. Now, I knew for a long time because the people who remember they had that show on TV that was all about these guys who could tell what you were really thinking because of your face.
They were face experts. Could tell you were lying.
Yeah, I don't know how that show lasted so long. How many episodes about that can you? But one of the big things, like people who play poker, they can do a tell.
Right.
You do touch your nose. I noticed this. I knew about if you feel a little bit embarrassed or like you haven't done something right. I had learned about that you apparently we touch our noses, and I used to drive a manual stick shift. And after I learned that piece of information, I started to notice that whenever I missed a gear, I would touch my nose. It's almost like I'm looking around the people that are around me like, hey, nothing happened there. Everything's fine. And I went, wow, I guess there's some truth to that. But 23 times an hour.
Look, I'm doing it again. I'm scratching my little beard.
Yeah. What's
because it's a little beard.
Yeah. What 23 times an hour we have a negative thought about ourselves and we have to touch our face in some sort of.
I have way more than that.
Very difficult. Well, you're touching your face. Well, you know what? He just touched
my
his
hand.
Hold on, everybody. Andrew's touched his face again. We got to go through this again. Bring in the sanitation crew. All right.
And spray Tim, not me. Spray Tim. Spray him.
Oh, dear. My goodness.
Hate Lysol.
They say it's better. They say it's more than Lysol. It's this guy told me that it's DDT on steroids. So don't let that bother you. When I told the sanitation crew, when they said, well, how strong do you want the anti-coronavirus stuff? This was what I said to them. I said, dial it up to death and then pull it back one notch. I think that's pretty good, right? That's I mean, we live, we barely live.
Yeah.
But the coronavirus, you see, doesn't stand a chance.
No. Unlike those other quitters, he won't be suspending his campaign. Eric Von Haessler, libertarian candidate for president of the Common Sense Coalition of People Against Political Noise and that kind of tired old stuff. Weekdays 9 till noon on 95.5 WSB.
Right, what, did the president stand up the entire city of Atlanta?
Yes, he did.
Supposed to be here today?
Excuse me.
It's been postponed.
Why aren't you coming to Atlanta?
Because there were some very awful storms in Nashville, and that is where I'm going.
I know, but I mean, we're not far from, you could stop there. Going to Florida afterwards.
Oh, hop, skip, and a jump? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, you get in the plane. How far?
I got a tea time.
I agree that the terrible tornadoes in Nashville, sure, you need to go there. But we're not that far away.
I got good
air
people.
Travel.
I got good people working for me. They're going to go down there.
It's probably better. If you're at the CDC, no matter what your politics are, it's you actually, how much can you get done? We're in a race against time here with the coronavirus. How much can you actually get done when the president's coming? Everything kind of freezes. You can't really do a lot of work.
A lot of people have told me that it's been raining for, I don't know, biblically for 40 days in Atlanta. Yes. Every day, a lot of rain, and the traffic has been bad. Today is the first day where the sun is shining. I didn't want to drive everybody nuts.
Yeah, that's true. I don't know why.
Wash your hands, wear your Bane from Batman mask. You'll keep it all away.
I have to say that the Secret Service, you have to, people, you know, people don't give you credit when things don't happen, right? Secret Service has done one hell of a job keeping our president safe, you know, since let's go back to Ford, where there was but they kept him safe even then, you know. I know Reagan, you know, but I mean, the Secret Service has done a hell of a job. When you think of all the crazies out there, the Secret Service has done a hell of a job keeping our president safe, especially now where no matter who's president, half the country hates the person, and then there are crazies amongst those. So they do a good job. But I just like, why does so much of the city have to be shut down? Can we come in with a better route? Here's my idea. Just have everybody go meet the president at the airport, and then have him land like a lot out, you know, at the base, not
at Dobbins.
Do things that way. The last time the president was in town, for some reason there was some need to be in Buckhead, then go up 400. Well, you couldn't make it worse for anyone. I was going in the opposite direction. I was going home while that was going on, and it was bizarre to look over the barrier and see no one on 400. It's like, there has to be no one on 400.
Couldn't he land and take a helicopter to the CDC? You have to assume that they have a helicopter launch.
But I think what you'd have to worry about is you could not. That's low. I don't know what I'm talking about here, but that's you're in low airspace.
Mm-hmm.
And once people knew that the president started traveling that way, it wouldn't be that difficult, you know, maybe if some militia group had an RPG or something. So I don't think that's a good way to go. You have to, the best way is by vehicle and nobody's around, but take a little time and make that footprint as small as possible. You know, the governor can go out to the airport. You just have to go to the governor, or you can have meetings.
I don't like going out there.
I'm sorry, sir, but it makes it easier for everyone else.
Come to my house, we might dinner.
Right.
I would have liked to have seen Trump go to the CDC and ask questions like whether the flu vaccine would work and whether Lysol would be good or not.
We know that Lysol kills
the
virus.
No, it does not work.
It does on a countertop.
It can on a countertop.
So don't chew up the Lysol wipes and swallow them because it's not going to work.
Okay,
I tried.
There's good advice. You tried. It was some sort of challenge online.
It was the Lysol wipe, chew it up and swallow it challenge on TikTok.
You embarrass her.
It doesn't help. It just doesn't help. So don't even try. What do you have for me?
Well, in the other news too here locally in Georgia, Governor Kemp came out yesterday and said that there are no new cases of coronavirus. We still have just
still
the
two.
And basically, no time to panic.
They're a little worried about the kid because the kid went to. It's weird. It's homeschool, but he went to school. I'm a little confused.
They have places where they get together and do activities.
Oh, this is so
homeschools. They have like a group of moms and parents.
So they're part of extracurricular stuff as well.
See, okay. And socialized.
Okay, I get that. So because for a while we were producing homeschool students who were geniuses, but a little awkward at a party. So now homeschoolers are realizing, well, let's get together. You know, let's play baseball and tennis and have some social interaction. Okay, so the kid went to one of these places. And then sat next to another kid who went to another one of those. So two of those places are shut down. The get together home learning
the
places.
So in Cherokee County, right?
But so far, what we know is we still only have two. Now here's the fact. All right, I'm going to tell you what's real. As we get more of these testing kits out there, and as more people get tested, we're probably going to find out that there are a few more. You still should not panic. I'm being a leader. Remember I talked about leading by example?
Yeah.
Ask me what I've changed in my life.
What have you changed in your life, Eric?
Absolutely nothing. Well, except that I wash my hands more often. I like this idea of you walk in your house, you wash your hands. You know? But then I realize the next thing I do is I pick up my phone, which, you know, if you look at the studies on that, you know, every horrible thing is sticking to the face of your smartphone or your iPad. But you know, all you can do is just keep yourself cleaned a little more. I'm trying to stop touching my face. As I mentioned earlier, I'm trying to stop touching Jared's face.
It's hard though.
It's like so baby soft, you know?
He doesn't have whiskers.
You know what I'm doing is I'm starting to brush his face with the back of my hand.
Yeah, that's good.
Because I think that's better.
It's a little better.
Yeah,
and the smell lingers a little longer.
Yeah,
too,
yeah, yeah.
Later.
I go back into my corner. I go back to my corner and I just think, oh, youth. Oh, I was young once. Yeah. Oh, yes. It's
subtle.
It's an elixir, I think.
It is.
Puts me in a good mood.
That's what Joe uses.
Yeah. Joe Biden. Yeah. You know, Joe Biden, the way he touches people and smells people, he could end up being patient zero once if he's out there as the nominee.
Let me smell your life force, buddy.
Smell your life force. It's like we could have this thing almost contained, and then this guy starts crossing the country in late summer.
I'm going to crush your brain blood barrier there, buddy.
You'll reignite this thing. It's a possibility.
I still think that these catchy songs that they're using are working. I actually heard somebody. I was at a restaurant last night.
Are you talking about the V-pop song, Vietnamese?
I didn't hear the Vietnamese song, but I did hear somebody singing in the bathroom while I was out to dinner last night.
An adult.
The Vietnamese one is a banger.
Look, I don't need to sing happy. You know what? As an adult in this world, I can basically kind of time out 20 seconds. You know, I don't need to sing to myself.
But if you have this, Eric, come on.
Wash, 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 wash. Wipe, 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 wipe. And don't touch Jared's face no matter how soft it is. I don't know what's harder to stop doing, Tim Andrews. Touching my face or touching Jared's face. But we live in important times, and it's important, and I'm going to do the best I can to stop touching my face and Jared's face. And that's leading by example, people. Follow me. You know, what are we doing? Are we doing, we're doing from Studio B1 here?
Yeah, we got Greg right. 2 days in a row.
I couldn't be more excited. Before we get there, I have to say that I already made Autumn's day. I did the old, I did that thing where, because you know, I had glasses on and I have really long hair right now and I have my hat on.
Yeah.
And when she was looking at me, and in just one moment, I ripped off the hat, shook the hair out, took off the glasses. Guess what? Librarian Eric becomes
That's right.
Hot.
I didn't.
Huh?
I didn't know how hot you secretly were.
Oh, yeah, I was holding it in. You thought I was like one of these accountant mousy types.
Yeah, I thought you were worked at the library.
You had no idea that underneath this cap was Fabio waiting to emerge. All right, let's do this.
He's a misanthrope. He has a dark heart. And he needs a good psychiatrist.
Here you are.
It's Greg Russ with stories from Studio B1.
You see, Greg Russ has curly hair, so no matter how long it gets, he can't do what I just did. He can't pull the cap off and, you know, shake his hair out because it's just just Brillo. You know, it's just big.
I can
white boy fro. Yes,
I can cut my own hair.
That is true.
I've been doing it for 10 years at this point. I've not paid for a haircut in 10 years because. Yeah, because it is curly. If you straightened it, it'd be various lengths all across the head.
But you can't notice because you got those Shirley Temple-like locks.
Yeah, it looks beautiful.
Yeah, just because.
Yeah, let's straighten it so we can see what kind of what kind of mess you've made of your hair.
Hey, wait
bring
a minute.
Bring the what is it? Yeah. The flat iron? What is what do you straighten hair
bring
with?
Bring on the flat iron.
That's right.
Sounds like a torture
straight
device.
Hair straightener.
It does.
We'll make him talk yet. Bring it out to the flat iron.
That's why I hesitated. It didn't seem right. It did seem like something I was used to torture.
You could get a keratin treatment.
You ever hear the, what's a keratin treatment?
That's when they put keratin in your hair and straighten it. It takes about 2 hours.
You ever hear the,
they take people's fingernails and they melt them down. That's where keratin comes from.
Is that where it comes from? Okay. I had no idea. That's one of the things we learned from Studio B1. You ever hear that urban myth? And we can't go into it. It's a family show. The urban myth about the curling iron thing and then leave it in and leave the room. You know that one, Greg? That scares the heck out of me. I'll tell you what. I don't even allow my wife to tie me up just because of that urban myth. I don't know. Alan, do you know the one I'm talking about? Did it get around everywhere?
Yeah, I started it.
I was in the Northeast at the time as a teenager. You hear the story. I can't imagine it ever happened anywhere. We'd have to look it up and see. Jared, do you know what I'm talking about? Did it make it to your?
It never did.
The curling iron... would you call bondage S&M, right? You're tied up, right?
Yeah, S&M.
Just put it this way: it's placed in the wrong place, plugged in, turned on, and then the person leaves. That's all
slowly
you need to know.
Warms up.
We don't need it. We don't need to know any more than that. I don't think it ever actually happened.
How do you survive in this world with so much misinformation out there? in the past, when you would just hear these legends, urban legends, here and there, it has affected your life to the point where it's altered behavior and you just don't do anything. Well, so I don't know how you survive.
I don't know. I think it's a good idea to never allow anyone to tie you up in any situation. I don't trust anybody. Like, I've been with my wife 32 years, but you don't really know what's rattling around in the mind. Hey, who knows?
I guess.
Maybe she'll think, hey, you know what? Arsenic takes too long. I gotta get rid of this guy. I'll just set up some kind of bizarre, embarrassing, I can blame it on him kind of thing.
He cut his own femoral artery.
I don't know what it was. All right, what do you got there from Studio B1?
I want you to partake in the National Day of Unplugging. So it's a public service announcement. That's what I've got. I'm starting with this service announcement that starting today at sundown through tomorrow, sundown, you need to unplug.
Doesn't that go along with Sabbath? For Friday night to Saturday night?
I believe so.
For our Jewish friends?
Well, that's the good thing here in New York. There's a big Hasidic Jewish community, and they have these air raid sirens that go off an hour before sundown on Fridays. Mm-hmm. So I could listen for those.
I gotta get home.
How long did you live there before you realized that they weren't bombings coming in? An air raid siren goes off.
I knew pretty quickly just because their community is very centralized.
Yeah.
And it is like going to another country. So, it's one of the things moving here.
Greg told me that they can ask you to turn on the lights, though. And he's been invited in, like been walking by people's places.
He's a house goy?
Yeah. He's like, he'll walk.
Yeah, you go turn the lights on, cook for them.
But is it not true that you've been invited in as you've been walking through neighborhoods because like somebody can't turn the stove on or something?
Yeah, it was an air conditioner.
Right.
I was walking past and he asked me, are you Jewish? And I knew if I said yes, that I figured what was happening. So I said, no, I'm half Jewish, but I don't know if that probably wouldn't count for them.
Yeah. Yeah.
They'd probably, okay, you don't count.
Are you really half or more third?
No, it's like half.
Are you only half? Okay. I didn't realize that.
Right. It's a little under.
Is it 23andMe confirmed, Greg?
Yeah, it has been through my sister.
Oh. Okay. Well,
have you ever looked at my profile?
So wait a minute, hold on.
Yeah, look at him.
Yes. No.
Hair you were talking about earlier. I'm sorry to throw the stereotypes out there, but I look Jewish.
Yes. I always thought it was rather Romanesque, your look. But
the correct term.
But wait a minute. But so really, you lied. Actually, you put these people in peril.
No, but he's not religiously Jewish. He's he's a heritagely Jewish.
Sounds no, like it doesn't count because it wasn't passed to my mom. So they would never accept me.
All right. Okay.
So anyway, I went in. And I turned the air conditioner on. He's a little lower. And I turned it a little bit lower.
Then
I did, no, that's too low. And then I said, okay, I actually leave it. And then I was walking out, and they offered me a Coors Light. But there were 18 people in the house.
18?
And part of me was interested.
You really helped people. If it was that hot and there were 18 people, you were a lifesaver that day.
Well, part of me wanted to hang out.
Yeah.
But I got frightened. Because I didn't know what we would talk about.
Yeah. It's like, I guess if you talk about the weather and then sports.
Yeah, it's hot, huh?
And, you know, then they might say, and then in the middle of it, they might find out that you lied and that you're actually weren't supposed to touch the. No, actually, if it was something for your mother, it's okay. Listen, we've gone down a rabbit hole here. National Unplugging Day is how we started.
Yeah. How did we get here?
You need to disconnect from your digital devices so you can connect with yourself and others and your loved ones. Because, Eric, we're missing out. We're really just missing out on life's precious moments as we bury our faces
in
these digital devices.
So we should just disconnect from our soundboard here, right, Eric? Just like this?
No.
It's not. Oh my God. No one wants to hear that noise.
Well, it's the plugging in on National Unplugging Day.
It's also at sundown. You didn't listen. It happens at sundown.
All right. Well, I think if people starting at sundown, I'm on board for this.
What about
the
TV?
I think that, everything.
Yeah, you can't watch
it's supposed
TV.
To be everything. We think about screens and any kind of stuff. It would be nice to get away from that stuff. So I think people should still listen to the radio, but only on wind-up radios. You know those wind-up. There's nothing is better than listening to the radio and hearing.
I listen to it through my pillowcase.
There you go. Some people are lucky enough. They're just they can hear radio waves in their teeth.
I still only pick up Art Bell on mine. You wind it up, it's still the Art Bell show.
Well, remember,
I was in the kitchen and heard it through my cast iron.
Yeah.
When WSB first launched, it was so powerful that people were hearing. Through their pots and pans
that
in the kitchen.
That was quite a day.
We have Adam A. Moore here. She was listening on day one in 1922. She heard it through her cast iron.
I went in there and I said, Mama, I can hear the radio here in the kitchen. And she said, well, that's the new radio station down the road. WSB, I think.
And so it was coming right through the frying pan.
Coming right through the frying pan. I thought maybe there was a poltergeist or something.
Years later, we had to pay a lot of medical bills. It was a new technology in 1922.
We're experimenting with things.
We didn't know you weren't supposed to turn it up.
But it was worth it because we heard jazz.
Yeah, you heard jazz music on your teeth.
Dixieland.
All right. I do believe that people are a little too connected to stuff, but I can say what I want. But tonight,
well, one day, what is one day going to do?
Well,
I understand you're trying to create some awareness, but nobody, if anyone does do it for the one day, they're not doing it after the day.
That's right.
You should just make the choice. You shouldn't need a day to make this kind of choice in your life. Why don't you just say, hey, I'm self-aware, and I realize that I've had my nose in this phone all day, and there's people around me that maybe I should talk to them.
You know
what am I avoiding by keeping my face
I know
in
what
this
I'm
phone?
I know what I'm avoiding, and it bothers me. Now, I'm not so much with the screens, because I'm pretty good at my phone and my iPad. It's really kind of utility to me. I use it for work and gathering stuff. I don't have a nose in it all the time. I'm from the old school. My problem is still television. I watch too much television and any kind of downtime. I'm very good. I don't sit around eating potato chips and ice cream anymore, but I'm still sitting there watching television, and I realize that I'm not reading books like I used to. I'm going to get back.
You
can't do both. Well, I like audiobooks a little bit because I have a very dull... Greg reads a lot of books, and he won't read on Kindle. He reads books. But let me ask you this, Greg. I find that I have a very... The reading voice in my head is very, very monotone and dull. So I like audiobooks because you get people who are paid to actually throw a little...
Yeah, actors.
Yeah, a little pizzazz into...
I don't like that because I like creating what the characters sound like and act like in my own mind. Yeah. And then that way it's put forth for me.
Yeah, and that's the beauty of a book, right? In a strange way, you can read the same book that I read, full of a bunch of characters, and we both walk away with slightly different ideas of what the characters look like.
Well,
sound
the whole
like.
World they live in looks different.
Yeah,
if we could somehow translate that visually, if we could draw it or just express it, with that world that these characters live, just the buildings, for example, or what their house looks like.
So then, if you let Jean-Luc Picard read it to you, then everybody's kind of got the same idea.
It was the best of times. Engage.
But I have this dull. Sometimes I go back and I read a chapter over again because I realize
Does your brain wander when you're reading?
That happens.
Yeah. That's what happens to me.
Problem with audiobooks. I like listening to people who can really, really make it come alive, but my brain starts to wander and I gotta
sometimes
go back.
Sometimes while I'm reading, I think to myself, look at me, I'm reading.
And then you realize, like, that's all I've
and
been saying.
And then I missed, like, six paragraphs.
Or the opposite.
Go ahead.
No,
Go ahead.
I was gonna say, or the opposite. If you're when I'm on a long drive and I'm listening to a car, I always suddenly look
listening
up.
To a car.
I'm sorry, I'm listening to an audiobook. I look up and oh my god, I'm out of Virginia already.
Yeah.
You lose time.
Yeah. You really do.
Yeah, yeah. And hopefully, have you ever been driving around and you think that you've not been paying attention for the last 10 minutes, but surely you must have.
Yeah, because you didn't get in a wreck.
You didn't get in a wreck, and there's slight curves in the road. Be like, what happened in the last 10 minutes?
I love the thing where you go on autopilot, and you just start driving to some place you're used to driving, and you've realized you've gone the opposite direction.
Yeah.
I'm trying to go to Kroger? Yeah. What am I doing?
Yeah, you know, it's very interesting, especially if you get on expressways and things like that. There's no difference. If you drive long enough, going north or going south looks exactly the same. So if you go the wrong way when you get off, like a rest area or something, you can go like 23 miles. Why am I back in Silverton? Didn't I go past Silverton?
Yeah, I saw exit 17 already.
I've always thought that it's bizarre that if you think about it when you're driving, you can imagine you're going in any direction. West, east, north, south. We really do need these signs. Otherwise, we'll just drive off the end of the earth. And yes, there is an end of the earth. Don't doubt me. Come on, Greg. We don't have a lot of time. This isn't the longest segment in the world. Give me another story from Studio B1.
No, you should bring me on for a full hour. That's what you should start doing.
You want to start doing that? You want to do Greg Hour? Greg Hour?
No, because I come on, then we chat about things, we catch up, and then we get to the stories.
Hey, you want to do a podcast together? Maybe we should do a podcast together.
Two topics.
Yeah, two topics.
Yeah.
All the topics.
You guys already do. Autumn and Greg have a podcast called One Topic, which, by the way, is a little bit of a lie because, you know, the topics are usually umbrella-like and you have a bunch of things inside.
So you listened?
No, to me... One topic would be like paper clips, and then you just talk about paper clips.
We did do socks,
but they talk about stuff like they'll say one topic, religion, and then there's a million things to talk about.
Well, that's still one topic.
Sure, I understand, but if we did a podcast, what would it revolve around? What would it so we could just talk as much as we wanted to? We'll talk about daredevils and what a fake and phony that Nick LaLenda.
That would be a great topic if we had you on.
No. I'm talking about, I'm sorry. We don't need you anymore. Greg and I are starting our own podcast.
Oh, wow. Oh. You're just
pushing the lady out.
This podcast.
I hear from Liz Warren and Nancy Pelosi there's still an awful lot of misogyny around. I don't see it.
Well, that can be our kickoff episode.
Yeah.
Also, here's my last story. RIP copycat. World's first clone cat dies at 18.
Well, 18, that's a pretty good run for a cat.
Yeah.
People who clone their pets are evil, as far as I'm concerned. Why do we spay and neuter all the time? We don't want these pets. Go get a pet that's alive. Don't create. We have pets walking around. Nothing worse than a pet without
Adopt.
A home.
Don't
Adopt.
Shop.
Adopt. Don't
shop.
And or edit. Hour two of the Von Haessler Doctrine begins. Right now, I just did it again. I touched my nose. But I do it with the back of my... I do it with my knuckles now. I'm doing everything I can to just touch my face with the back of my hand because I'm never going to be able to stop touching my face. Look, we got Wes Moss here. We got things going on. So let's just go ahead and open it up, Alan. Let's do this.
More headlines for Friday, March 6th.
Wes Moss. Yeah, we're all cheering. Wes Moss.
Yay.
Host of Money Matters right here. Right here. Sundays at... my brain is going.
Nine a.m.
I knew. I just didn't want to get it wrong. I just want. By the way, hold on, Wes. I just. I hate to put you through this, but every once in a while, when we start every new hour, I have a sanitation crew. I have them on retainer, and so before, let's just spray down the studio real quick here.
It's good. It's good for you.
You're gonna mess up Wes's hair.
Not possible.
All right, sorry about that. But
what should I invest?
Tim won't stop touching his face, and strangely enough, I won't stop touching Jared's face, which I don't.
You guys are cute.
I didn't even realize how often I touched other people's faces until we got into this.
It just felt like being in the middle of Wuhan, China. That's what they do on the streets.
Yeah, well,
day.
You know what?
I'm here.
Unlike that country, I'm trying to get ahead of it. See, if they had been spraying the streets, say, a year ago, none of this ever would have happened. So I'm getting ahead of it. Wes Moss, host of Money Matters, right here on WSB. We have you in, of course, because the Wall Street again, roller coaster ride. We go from 1,000 points down to 1,000 points up to... I heard this morning, and tell me if this is true, that there's the balancing act going on between what's going to happen with the coronavirus and how bad can that get and how long will it last in terms of production and interrupting production. And on the other hand, how much is the Fed going to help and get in there and cut rates again and all that? And so people are trying to figure this sort of thing out. Where does it stand?
Eric, in the 20 plus years that I've been doing investments, studying the economy, and I have an economics degree from the University of North Carolina. I love studying the economy and then consumer psychology. Mm-hmm. And right now, in over 20 years, this is the largest disconnect between conventional wisdom, what people think about the coronavirus in all capacities, and the reality of coronavirus.
Yes.
And I can't get any more emphatic about how big of a disconnect is going on. This morning, Secretary of State Mike Pompeo was on CNBC. His advice to Americans, hey, what should we be doing? What's the outlook for this? What should Americans be doing? His advice was, go to the CDC website. And I said, that's the best you can do? Yeah, that's the best our government leaders can do about informing the public that are already grossly misinformed.
Yeah.
Grossly misinformed.
Now, when you say grossly misinformed, do you think that there's a playing up of fear? Now, so the answer is yes. We're dealing with fear here, right?
And when we have a massive fear.
What I want to point out, and we know this, and being in the media ourselves, we are not necessarily above this, but we know fear sells.
It does.
Fear sells. And all these news and information, your 24-hour news network, every blog that needs you to click, all of this stuff is dependent upon you clicking through, sticking around, not changing. Now, this show, we're so damn good. We don't need it. Most shows don't have what we have, namely me. So they have to go out and try to scare you. But Wall Street is dealing with fear and uncertainty right now, right?
It's a true fear and true uncertainty, and this will last for a while. And there is a case to be made that even though this gets cleaned up relatively quickly,
that's what I think is going to happen.
There is somewhat permanent economic damage that can be done. I think the jury's still out on that. But here's the deal, and I have been as voraciously on a search for the truth in this than anybody that I know. And it's because I care so much about seek to understand first.
Yes.
And I almost love these times where the world is panicking, yet I have a very clear understanding of where we're going to be in about, call it 30 days.
Right.
And I think that's really important.
Where do you think we're going to be in 30 days?
I think where we're going to be in 30 days is that the world will slowly wake up to the fact, and they'll look at, and I've got two important examples. One is the South Korea data. They're a first world country. They care about their people and they report what is real. They have tested because they were ready because of MERS. They actually
had dealt with this before.
Test kits ready, 158,000 tests.
Mm.
That is exponentially higher than what we've done. 6,300 infections, coronavirus, and 46 deaths. What's the math on that? It's a 0.6. It's a little worse than the seasonal flu. Now, it's been handled wrong how this is being communicated. Yesterday, the World Health Organization came out and said 3.4% death rate.
Yeah.
Well, if you've got, if the general public is saying, oh my gosh, three or four people out of 100 are dying, you know what you're going to do? You're not even going to Starbucks.
Yeah, you're certainly not going to the movies.
You're not going to South by Southwest.
Right. Yeah.
You are staying home, you're canceling conventions, you're not traveling, and that is wreaking havoc on everywhere from airlines to cruise lines, and then the fuel that goes in the airlines, there's lower energy demand, so oil prices are lower, then people are running to bonds, that's pushing interest rates down, and it's crushing the banks, by the way. Mm-hmm. So you get this fear chain reaction, and it is not based in reality. There will be a day, and I would say sooner than later, that the world wakes up to the fact that, and again, this is I've got this information from immunologists and infectious disease specialists at Johns Hopkins University, number one. I've corroborated this with the CDC, so a retired 30-year professional who ran an epidemiology at the CDC to mm-hmm. make sure that these doctors agree, that we are going to relatively soon find out that the mortality rate, which is the key crux of this whole thing, 3% mortality rate stops you in your tracks, a 0.3 or a 0.4, it's business as usual, but we're going to fist bump instead of shake hands. We're going to wash our hands.
And we're going to wash it right.
And then, that is this massive difference between those two numbers is not in the vernacular yet. And it will be, I think, in the next, call it short, I'd say maybe in the next 2 weeks. It may take a month and a half, but I don't see it going longer than
that.
See,
what you're talking about, what I was talking about, kind of come together with a lot of these headlines. This is what I consider to be a fishy headline from a few days ago. The number of cases has peaked in China, but it's growing in America. Wait a minute. First of all, China gave us bad numbers for weeks, and then they just went ahead and did a massive dump number, right? Okay, let's catch up with reality. So no, in reality, but it's just now whatever cases are getting to the United States. So in a percentage way, you could say that's true, but it's still 80,000 to like 60. You could say that, well, because you got 10 more cases in a week when it was only one case last week, right? Percentage-wise, you could say it's growing more in the United States, whereas it's peaked after they lied for a month about how many numbers they had. In reality, there's going to be a little bit of a wave here because people have to leave China, come here, talk to other people, then they have to be tested. So we're going to have an upswing, but that headline seems to lead you to believe that, oh, we'll be at 80,000. It doesn't mean that at all. It just means that if you found one last week and 10 this week, percentage-wise, week over week, that's a large bump.
I've got some real thoughts on that.
Yeah.
The first of all, if you speak to, so there's did several different reports. One of the doctors that I'm actually interviewing today that I'll have on Money Matters on Sunday, I'll have clips of that, but Sunday's 9 to 11. Dr. Amesh Adalaji, infectious disease immunologist from Johns Hopkins. He believes that this has, and this is where I actually do get a little disagreement between Johns Hopkins and CDC contacts I have.
They've never gotten along.
there's no romance between the two. The reality here is that one says that it's so much like the flu, not the flu, so much like the flu that it is actually going to be enormously widespread. Mm-hmm. And it's just a matter of looking for it. And now we're going to go from testing like a couple hundred people
to testing
millions.
Millions. And guess what? We're going to get more cases because we're going to find out. We're going to find out what we don't know today.
And the media is going to say, case to your point, it's going to say we found 10,000 new cases. Well, the market and the world's already freaking out over two new. It's like, mm-hmm. I took a screenshot of two new cases in LA, breaking news, red, and then red markets. Yeah. And I'm thinking, wait a minute, wait until next week. And they say cases jumped to 20,000. How misleading is that? Because they didn't jump to 20,000. 20,000 are already here. This thing has been percolating since November.
Yeah.
November. Yeah. It's March.
Yeah. How many people have traveled to China and back and were here for 14 days? How many people had it, got rid of it, didn't know they ever had it? And then how many people did they talk to, right? And how many people did they... Yeah,
sneeze
there's going to be a little bit more. Now, my sense is that it's going to be something that we kind of real, like you said, we're going to find out that the death rate is not as high as we think that it is now. This is my speculation, and I'm willing to put it out there as speculation. But I've been through these things. I've seen how these things work and how panic works. And there are people who just want to be panicked. There's nothing that you can do about that. But I think that once we're basically what's going to happen is in a couple of years, we're going to have a vaccine, and this is going to be one of those strains that's out there. And it's not going to kill most people, and it's going to be something that most of us deal with, and we're going to be back to business as usual. Not in 2 years. I agree with you. 30 to 60 days, I think we're going to have a lot more information. Well, you came in. Will you stick around for a few moments?
Just a few more.
All right. We'll get what we can from the great host of Money Matters, Wes Moss, when we get back. Wes Moss, host of Money Matters right here on Sundays, 9 to 11. Thank you for sticking with us. Talk about this. You're a voice of reason and sanity on the coronavirus. Now, obviously, things are different if you were planning on retiring in 2 months and you've got money. I'm 55. If my health holds out, I still feel like I have 10 more years of working. But so to me, and I'm not a big stock picker or anything, I 401ks, mutual funds. So I'm not even thinking about it. I think that this is, when we talk about, we're reacting to fear and uncertainty, because the Wall Street is always wants things to be certain. So when you're reacting to fear and uncertainty, before we get back to the actual specifics of what's going on with the coronavirus, I have a feeling that so long as this doesn't last to the point where it hurts underlying fundamentals of the economy, there may be a lot of torque buildup in the economy to where once we get the all clear, we might just blow right out again, right? That's my feeling.
Yeah, I'm seeing a herd mentality.
Yeah,
and you know, and I'm going to make a comment about Jamie Dimon, who's the CEO of.
He just had a heart attack or something.
Of J.P. Morgan, mm-hmm. had this inner aortic tear, and that he rushed to the hospital. They caught it early. He is always a voice of reason and leadership on Wall Street, and he's out of commission for a little while. But I could see something like this. Let's play this out for just a second. That Jamie Dimon is, let's say he's out in the hospital and he comes back in a month, and he comes back and he looks around and most Fortune 500 companies have stopped travel. Well, I've talked to a lot of C-level executives over the last week because I was considering stopping travel for my company. Mm-hmm. And I said, you know, why did you guys stop travel? And why did you guys stop travel? Most of them said, because they stopped travel. So they mostly are saying, well, and then what if, we don't know.
CYA,
what if somebody gets sick, and then we get sued, and it's liability, and it's kind of like, if you're a C-level exec, you basically you're saying, well, if they're doing it, then I got to do it, just in case.
Yeah. It's like if one tech company pulls out of a conference or something, then everybody needs to, because if you didn't pull out, and one of your people becomes sick, you got a big... You got a big problem.
So I see Jamie Dimon, God bless him, in recovering, comes back in a month, and he's kind of a tough leader kind of guy. I could see him saying, what is wrong with you people? Why is everybody shutting their life down? He goes, let's get back to travel. Yeah. And then everybody does the reverse. Oh, everybody goes back to travel. And I could see something like that happening where you get a voice of reason who's a leader that says, guys, we've learned that this is not... gonna kill everybody, and this is a little bit worse than the flu. We need to wash our hands, and we might actually get better at all of this.
Sure,
we might be better at public health in the next year.
Now, how much? Here's a good question. A lot of times in situations like this, companies find out they can do without certain things because they have to, and how much doesn't come back. With all the shedding of jobs from the crash. Back in the 2000s, a lot of companies found out as we came back, you know what, we were a little overbloated. We don't need all of those. So will companies find out, you know what, we can do a lot more of these meetings by FaceTime because we know now. We did it for 2 or 3 months. Guess what? Maybe we found out that it was better than buying a plane ticket for everybody to go out. Could we end up somewhere next year where all of this is gone, but... It's creative destruction, but we actually found that it's a little more efficient. We don't actually have to fly everywhere and get together to have these meetings. It's possible there could be a real shift in how things are done a bit here, right?
I had that exact conversation with my other business partners, and I said, Well, and by the way, there are companies right now that are testing, even though they don't feel like they need to do this, they're testing, hey, can we work from home? How efficient are we? And I had this exact conversation that is, wow, if we spend, and let's just make up round numbers, so we spend $1 million a year on travel, yet if we stop traveling and we continue, we still get 90% of the growth that we had last year, and yet we just saved $1 million in travel, then we're so much better off. Then why wouldn't we just pretty much stop traveling?
Yeah.
I had that exact conversation yesterday with my business partners.
Yeah, this is a forced, you're forced into a test situation, right? So you can find out. Somebody may have thought of this beforehand. Hey, let's try to do this differently and do our stuff differently. Now that almost everybody is being forced to do it for a couple of months, after that, we can look at it and say, how much productivity? Maybe we gained a little productivity. We saved some money. I think some things are going to come out. Look, all of those companies that fired people after the crash, they didn't suddenly load back up to where they were. They realized, you know what? A tenth of them we really didn't need. And we found that out because we had to get rid of people.
Which means that we might have a slightly slower recovery. But I think my takeaway point is just that there will be a time that is sooner rather than later, and I don't know if that's weeks or a month or two, that the world starts to calm down and realizes this health scare is not enough to stop the economy in its tracks at all.
I agree with that. Wes Moss, thank you for joining us. Money Matters, great show. Sundays 9 to 11, you're going to have the doctors you were talking about. Be talking about exactly what you were doing. We got a little preview here because of the Von Haessler Doctrine. Yes,
Dr. Mesh Adelaja.
You guys have brought certainty to the market here. It was down 800. It's only down 530 now because of y'all's conversation.
We're talking the market up, Wes. Man, I am not telling you something you don't already know. But bringing it all back home. Hey, coffee is one hell of a powerful drug. I know this because, I mean, it just completely changes who I am. And you don't think about it because if you're like me, you start every day with a couple of cups of coffee. I don't drink it all day long, but before the show, I've usually got three cups of coffee under my belt. And I changed my schedule in the morning so I could sleep longer. What I was doing before.
Thank goodness.
All right. I was taking it out on the children, I guess. So I had to change my. But,
I had to wake up at 4 in the morning.
I was waking up at 4 in the morning.
For no reason.
So that I could do all my prep and audio and things like that before I left the house. And I'd leave the house.
Your morning constitution.
All that kind of stuff. But also I did all the audio clips that I wanted to bring in and new stories overnight. And then I would leave the house at like 6:15 and get here. But then I realized that if I just sleep till 5:30 and just get up, do what I need to do, get in the car, I can do all that prep here. But the difference is I don't get a cup of coffee before I leave the house. So I walk in this building like a zombie. It is amazing.
So I was like, good morning, Eric.
Yeah. Oh, no. And people ask me, of course, when I have no coffee in me is when people come up and start asking me the most complicated questions. You know, Eric, what do you think is going to happen on the market? I think Wes Moss is on. But then you take one cup of coffee and boom, there I am. It's kind of frightening. We don't think of caffeine as a drug, right? Because we don't usually, you know, think we're going to, that we can fly and jump off a building to our death. So we don't think of it as that kind of drug. But it is, it's really kind of weird if you think about how I can go from not being able to put two words together to being able to do a radio monologue in 5 minutes with the help of caffeine. So I just want to say, some drugs are good. I'm not saying, kids, don't be drinking your coffee at 12. But, you know, around 16, when the tests start mattering, let's get on it. Yes.
The best part of waking up is Folgers in your cup.
Oh, that's Paul Stanley who wants... do you want to do an open mic before we go to Paul?
I have an
Paul,
email.
Can you just hold on just one moment? I know Paul Stanley...
I'm fine. I'm just telling you.
Yeah, you did a...
It's psychotropic.
What did you do? You did on YouTube, there's a...
I did a commercial for Folgers and they never aired it.
They never aired it. And did you sing the best part?
The best part of waking up... It's Folgers in your cup.
They went with
Cher or something.
Johnny Cash, maybe. All right,
best
you
part of record now.
Yeah. If I could turn back coffee.
If I could turn on my coffee machine.
This
this email, guys, before we get to Paul,
I know this is a rabbit hole thing, but does Cher have a good singing voice or just one that's so, it's just so original that we like it? Is it good?
Why you like my voice? Because it's different.
When she was dating Jane?
Yeah.
When she was dating Jean back in the 70s, I asked him, I said, does she have a good voice? Or is it all, you know, we just like it because she's on media?
He liked my voice because it sounded weird.
She almost was born with an auto-tune in her throat.
We're from the people in the town.
She had that Travis Scott wobble long before he was born. Or warble, probably, I should say.
She was trapped.
She was trapped before trap was cool. Okay, you have an open mic.
Yeah, this is an email.
What's that? Excuse me?
If you'll be a little me.
She kind of sounds like she's drowning as she's
trying. I can feel something.
All right, this is apropos to nothing. Yes.
This email comes into the Von Haessler Doctrine at WSBRadio.com. It's subject line, Wes Moss. Says, Eric, as a fellow economist who studied at the fine University of West Georgia, I say more Wes Moss. Bring forth the Moss.
Yes, Wes was a great guest, and we appreciate having him here. And he, like me, is highly irresponsible for getting on the media and telling people not to panic. First time in history that people get on the on national and local media, the people who are saying don't panic, we are being pointed to as the irresponsible people. It's the first time. Oh, he didn't shout fire in a theater, and he's the irresponsible one. All right. Speaking of irresponsible, I'm not saying now, but you've had a long rock and roll career. Let's do this.
Hi, it's Paul Stanley, and this is Paul Stanley Presents, the latest in music and entertainment news, only on the Von Haessler Doctrine.
By way of introduction, let me just also let people know, Paul Stanley, you guys are on, the Kiss is on what they promise is their final farewell tour. I believe they've done 4 or 5 of them now.
Wow, the Staples Center the other night?
Yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah.
I wore my Kobe jersey.
Yeah? Very nice.
Fine tribute.
Homage.
Huh?
You were honoring the legacy.
Oh, that's right. Yes, this is the house that Kobe built.
That's right. And so you guys swear that on your lives that this is the last farewell tour. Paul Stanley came to me and said, Eric, one day after Kiss, I'd like to be an entertainment reporter. So we have him in when we can to dip your toe in.
Right.
Let's see how good you are at it. So what do you got in
Well, first of
Paul
all,
Stanley
Eric, you,
want,
you can ask me anything. You know why?
Why?
Because last night on Twitter, I didn't ask me anything, and I love reading all your questions and all your messages.
And then
I answered a lot of them.
I went through the transcript, and the answers seemed to be the same to a lot of questions.
What are you talking about?
Well, like somebody would ask you, you know, how if you like touring or something, and then your answer is,
I love my job.
Yeah, but that was the answer to a lot of things.
I love my job.
So is the Ask Me Anything open for me? Can I ask you anything?
Well, it got late, so I said no, but I'll let you go ahead.
I get one.
You get
one.
Jared, no.
Ask me anything,
Eric. Ask me anything, Eric.
I just want to hear Paul Stanley say that.
Hey, Eric, ask me anything, okay?
Okay. Paul Stanley from Kiss.
Yes.
The makeup.
Right.
Especially in the early years. Did it ever cause your skin to break out or anything?
I love my job.
You see, I thought it's always the same answer with you. It doesn't matter. It might be Ask Me Anything. It shouldn't be called Ask Me Anything with Paul Stanley. It's that the answer is going to be the same with Paul Stanley. You love your job.
Right.
Paul, can I ask you a question?
No. He said no.
I already said no.
No, it's
fine,
closed down.
Paul.
It's closed down.
Fine.
You know what? If you meet Paul at Phipps.
In my art gallery
in December, and if you buy a $1,000 painting, I think maybe you'll answer.
Hey Paul,
question.
Can you just sign this for me real quick?
I don't do that. Come to the sign. Look, I'm doing a signing tonight. It's $300, and I'll do a little doodle on
it. Paul, we're on the show together. You want to sign this for me?
No, I understand. You wanted to.
You're just going to sell it on eBay.
You wanted to dispel a rumor that's out there concerning.
Oh my
you
God!
Guys.
Fake news alert. You have a fake news alert. Every radio station that I'm on has one.
Yeah, that Clark Howard thing. Weep, weep, weep.
There is a story going around on Twitter that Gene and I are selling
masks.
Wait,
hold on. I do have a fake news alert.
Sure.
All right, so say fake news alert.
Fake news alert.
Let's hear for Senator Schumer!
There you go.
That was a good one.
Anyhow, the fake news is that Gene Simmons and I, as Kiss, are selling masks that will help you prevent getting the coronavirus. First
this was
all,
in the news. It was, in the news. Going around. Yeah, people said that you, because Kiss has a tendency to put their name on a lot of items, right, and you can buy them if you're a Kiss, part of the Kiss Army.
Exactly.
And so there was a story going around that said that you could get your very own Kiss coronavirus mask.
Right, but no, you can't. We don't have these masks.
You mean we can't kiss coronavirus goodbye?
Oh, I like that. I might give you some money to work on a... anyway, we'll talk later. But it's fake news. But listen, if things go bad, we do have Kiss caskets.
Okay.
That's true.
If they go the wrong way.
If they go the wrong way, you can still be buried and I don't know, I guess the afterworld know that you're a Kiss fan?
The underworld.
The underworld, well...
That's where Gene's going.
Is that where...
He's a demon.
Oh, wow,
he
come
spits
on.
Blood. I'm going to space with the rest of the lovers.
Does he? Well, you'll be up there with Ace, though. I don't know if you guys get along.
Space Ace?
Yeah, Space
you
Ace.
You know, we didn't call him that because he was an alien. He's just nuts. Space Ace. All right, you ready for a story?
Entertainment story.
So Captain Kirk was awarded horse semen in his divorce settlement.
William Shatner?
Yeah.
First of all,
I know him as
TJ
Hooker.
He's a very thirsty man.
I know that you know that, I know already that William Shatner has a horse. He has stables.
He loves horses.
He loves horses. And so this may seem like a shock jock headline, but in reality, this would be something of great value because he has been breeding these things. And so this is how you make money.
Right.
And you sell that and you buy and maybe one wins the Kentucky Derby one day. I don't know. So it must be valuable. The part of the story that blows me away is he's getting a divorce. Isn't he like 85
he's
years
88.
Old? He's 88 years old. What's he going to... I don't get this. What are you... Oh, now I can be footloose and fancy free.
He can go dating again.
Hey, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah, I'm going to go on Tinder. Was Captain Kirk. What,
beam right.
You're 88 years old. Don't you want somebody to find you? See, at 88.
To find you when you die?
Yeah. At 88, it's important to me that, you know, we have designated drivers when you go out to drink. I want a designated finder. I want to know that someone who knows me is going to find me. That, you know, and I want someone protective because just in case the last thing I was doing was a little bit embarrassing, awkward, or messy, I want someone who loves me enough to cover all that up.
See, I have a lady.
Book in your hand.
Yeah. I have a lady named Lupe who's at my house who will do that for me.
Oh, okay. You're all set.
Say, Lupe, get all the cleaning stuff ready. If I die doing this, you can clean it up.
I know
no
that you forget this all the time, but you are married. You have children.
Look.
Isn't he married? Didn't we find this out?
Yeah, he's married.
I am?
Yeah.
Yeah, you are, Paul.
I think so. I don't know. Listen, I'm not here to talk about me.
You got a family.
I'm here to talk about entertainment news.
Okay. All right.
Like William Shatner and his horse stuff.
Yeah, it's just amazing to me when people... I was thinking about this, you know, when people...
I wonder if she's single now.
I'm becoming very social. I don't want to say this in a way that makes people think I'm against gay marriage or something. I'm not. I'm a libertarian. I don't care what people do. But I myself, personally, I find and becoming more traditional as I get older. I was in a situation not too long ago where guys were like, you know, hey, look at her, like on the phone and everything. And I surprised myself. And this does not sound like me, but I surprised myself. I'm like, hey, you know, I'm an old man. These words actually came out of my mouth. My wife turned 60 this year. I'm not going to disrespect her that way.
I feel the same way.
I actually said that to somebody. I'm not going to disrespect her. She wasn't anywhere around. She would never have known.
It's admirable.
But I just think I don't want to be a creepy...
Admiral Kirk.
Getting right back to it.
I said admirable.
I don't want to be one of these creepy old guys.
It's like, hard.
You gotta know. Like in Paul Stanley, and this is hard for you. You know, in some societies, when you get to my age, long before you get to your age, you actually put on a different kind of uniform. Like you're in a different
so. I think in Japan they do that.
Yeah, it's like you're not even trying to be cool. You're not trying to be sexy. You're not trying to.
I did that.
Yeah. See, I don't know if I'm really being protective of my wife or myself or my relationship, or it really gets back to being selfish again. I just don't want to get the reputation of being a creepy old guy.
It doesn't work for me either.
Warning! Do not chug milk before listening, because you will laugh out loud.
Milk was a bad choice.
Eric and the Doctrinaires, mornings at 9. Mark Arum, evenings at 6 on 95.5 WSB.
All right, Paul Stanley, we're up against the clock. You know what that means.
No.
No.
Give me another story, fast.
Oh, okay, yeah, sorry. I'm learning radio lingo. Mm. So, Sports Illustrated swimsuit finalist Kathy Jacobs, who is 56 years old, is on a whirlwind journey, and she's bringing sexy back.
56 years of age. You have a little audio there?
Yeah, she says you can be sexy at any age.
Anyone out there that thinks that it's too light for them, I'm here to tell them that it's not.
What do you think, Paul Stanley? You've certainly had your time with people. Are you attracted here?
She's very nice looking, but she's too young for me.
Too young for you?
Yeah, she's
Paul
way
Stanley,
too young.
I did not expect to hear you
but
say
that. I'm sexy. I'm sexy as hell.
But are you changing your ways?
I changed my ways a long time ago. Look, I go for the audience. We still have groupies. They just have walkers and oxygen tanks.
Okay. And we have, this is a lady. They don't. Why does the 56-year-old get to all the press? We have a lady here. She's Lily. She's 82. Hi. She's one of the finalists.
I'm 82, and I'm still going strong.
Yeah, yeah. You're gonna.
I take medicine to keep me juicy.
Yeah, she sure does.
She takes medicine to keep her juicy.
Anyone out there that thinks that it's too light for them, I'm here to tell them that it's not.
Thank you, Paul Stanley.
Thank you.
You know, well, first of all, hour three of the Von Haessler Doctrine begins right now. I have a, you're a producer, right? Jared Yamamoto, you produce this show?
Yeah, I do a lot of things. I wear a lot of hats.
Yeah, but the main one is that you produce my show, right?
Yeah.
Isn't that the big hat?
After the Power Pod.
Well, no, I think my hat should be.
Well, of course. Bigger. I know what pays the bills. It's
sure.
The Von Haessler Doctrine. That's my
Everything
first priority.
Everything else is a side hustle, right?
Yeah.
And that's
the
fine.
Doctrine's your bread and butter.
Yeah, I call the Power Pods my side chick.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
And your girlfriend is on that show.
Yeah.
That's how he distracts her. And then after the show, he goes to see his real side chick.
I shouldn't have said that. I got to go work on my side chick.
Yeah,
tonight.
I should not have said that. So I get this, you know, I've spent like over $1,000 for this Rolling Stones show. Because I want to take it.
July 9th, right? Thursday.
July 9th, yeah. And they gave me two for free. Now this is now I appreciate the fact I said I want Wes Moss on the show. This producer, dogged as he is, he went and got him,
and so, I brought him in studio.
Absolutely. So I don't want. I want people to know. I think maybe not. That's going to be the theme for the next few minutes. Maybe, maybe not. But I don't know. Could we get Keith Richards on the phone? Could we? I mean, would
you
that
at least
not
reach
be,
out to the right
would,
people?
Would that not be the greatest thing in the world? For me to actually interview Keith Richards, would that not be the most monumental, greatest thing that's ever happened in the history of radio? At least for me. To hell with the audience.
We're the number one show.
Yeah.
This area, or whatever it is.
Yeah. I guess if the whole thing just sells out and it's all sold out by now, there's no need. But hey, just put it out there. You know, if there's a couple seats left over 3 weeks out. Somebody locally should say, you know, more than usual, there's this guy on the air. He's got a huge audience in Atlanta, and he's just a huge, you know, I'll take Mick. Look, yeah, but to me, Keith Richards.
Take Mick.
Keith Richards is one of my favorite people who ever lived, and that would be monumental. And he wouldn't even have to be awake or sober or anything. I'll carry the interview.
And we run a delay, so if something happens.
Do you have any more cocoa?
you'd be surprised. Keith is quite a gentleman. But let's get on to the maybes and the maybe nots. Let's do this.
Even more headlines for Friday, March 6th.
So I'm seeing a lot of maybes and maybe nots with Trump this morning. So we got here this morning coming in. We were told that Trump was canceling his trip to the CDC.
Yes, he was supposed to come
afternoon.
This afternoon, yeah.
And so you have him talking about it, right? Was this the White House lawn or something?
Yeah, this broke. No, it's actually, it looks like he's in like a disaster bunker. I think I might already be in Tennessee as it is now. But either way, though, this happened about 15 minutes ago. Sabrina carried it in the top of the hour newscast. And here's what he had to say about.
He's saying here he just landed in Nashville. So I don't think that's where he was when he said this. But go ahead.
So here's the latest.
There was, they thought there was a problem at CDC with somebody that had the virus. It turned out negative, so we're seeing if we can do it. But yesterday afternoon, we were informed that there may have been a person with a virus, and they now find out that was a negative test. They've tested the person very fully, and it was a negative test. So I may be going. We're going to see if they can turn it around with Secret Service.
And so do we know yet whether he is going to be here?
White House reporter Stephanie Grisham is reporting that he is planning to come to the CDC.
That's interesting.
Giving her credit for it,
though. We didn't have that piece of information earlier that we thought maybe somebody over there was...
Well, we're keeping it very low-key, and what we're doing is we're getting on the plane, and we might land in Atlanta. We'll certainly circle it for a little while.
So, well, you'll wave at the very least.
I will wave. We'll buzz it like it's a NASCAR race. And then... because it is on the way to Mar-a-Lago, where I plan on playing golf tomorrow.
Yes, okay. So, is that still around in the 3 o'clock hour? People need to know when these roads are going to be shut down.
I'm not seeing any specific times, but I assume the schedule would not change much.
I'll be landing at Petrie.
You
know, last time he gave a speech, in Buckhead, then had to move to another part. My guess is this time...
Yeah, land at Petrie to cab, take the MARTA right into the city.
Right.
My guess is this time it's going to affect more the south side if it's airport... to CDC, like that run, south side into the city. I wouldn't imagine it would be up on the top, but who knows?
Well, and as we get more information.
I know, because I'm going to be tuned into WSB.
Of course, because you're going to need the traffic reports as the president's motorcade is coming through town. Yeah, you do love Doug Turnbull.
I do, he's wonderful.
And
we'll get us all around town.
We got the sun out finally, so we can actually be up in the air, see what's going on. But I didn't even know what that was when I saw it this morning, the sun. Yeah, my goodness. Nice to have a nice sunny day. I was saying the maybes or the maybe nots were interesting because you got cut two there. Trump was talking about the coronavirus. I'm just going to run you through a lot of this audio we have so we don't leave it on the table. Number two, Trump on the coronavirus, and he said kind of the same sort of thing. Yeah, maybe, might have an impact, might not, who knows? Go ahead.
It certainly might have an impact. At the same time, I have to say, people are now staying in the United States, spending their money in the U.S., and I like that. We met with the airline companies yesterday. They're doing a fantastic job, and they're just not flying to areas that have a big problem. So it's going to all work out. Everybody has to be calm.
I haven't touched my face in weeks. In weeks.
Weeks.
I miss it.
I wish I could touch it right now, but I can't.
You can't. What do? You have big heads.
I'm working with the guy to invent a thing that you can touch your face with, like a scratch your face. Like, you know those things you scratch your back with that look like hands?
Oh, a back scratcher.
Yeah.
They're made out of bamboo.
Yeah, it's called a back scratcher. But that thing you scratch your back with, it's called a back scratcher.
Okay, that thing.
Here's the problem. You lay it down in between, and then it picks something up, and then you're back with your face.
Well, no,
you scratch your nose with it.
You're carrying a little sack that disinfects it every time you pull it out.
What was that stuff? You're soaking in it? Remember those commercials?
Palm olive. You can use palm olive to kill this virus.
No, you cannot.
It worked for Madge.
No, President Trump, it does not
work.
Look,
I met Madge.
I got rid of my dishpan hands.
See, Madge, no dishpan hands, no virus.
Madge is dead. And no.
She died.
Yeah, Madge.
From beyond the grave. It wasn't coronavirus that killed me. President... Thanks, palm olive.
How about that bounty lady? Bounty will soak up all of the
They're all dead.
Virus.
Joe the plumber, they're
That's
all dead.
That's Ponsol, baby.
No, it will not. You can't.
What about the Calgon lady?
The Calgon.
No, stay away from them.
No. We're a little too politically correct.
What?
Huh?
You know, I just got some instant information right here.
This is amazing.
This is what I love about smiling Mark McKay.
Yes.
So, first of all, President Trump's not going to land on the South Side. He's landing at Dobbins Air Force Base.
Okay.
So it'll be in Marietta. And smiling Mark McKay is going to be in for Doug Turnbull this evening, Mr. President.
I like smiling Mark. He's smiling. Smiling. Oh, there's no G. I understand. There's an apostrophe. Look, I remember when he was on CNN doing sports. I love him.
Okay. All right. Well, he'll be looking over you.
Okay.
And directing.
Hi, smiling.
Is it still in the 3 o'clock hour? Did he say? Or
I have no specifics about the time. But as we get them right here on 95.5 WSB,
absolutely,
you believe it, we will give it to you.
So into Dobbins, and then so whatever route you can work out to the CDC,
correct,
is going to be what's going to be affected, and then back, obviously. When presidents always come around rush hour, I never understood that. Just, you know what? Hey, the president's coming. Everybody stick around. Yeah, we're going to do it at like 9 o'clock at night. What's wrong with that?
We're going to land at 2 in the morning.
Yeah, exactly. Overnight.
Yeah, but the last time we did that, there were people doing donuts on 285.
That's true. You do. That's why they're landing at Dobbins. They can't trust the airport anymore. What with these hooligans shutting down large stretches of our roadways to drift. All right, what else you got? Oh, no, I got more audio I want to get to.
Okay.
So you had Governor Cuomo. He's not our governor. He's the governor.
My God.
He's
not
the governor.
My governor.
Not my governor.
He's nutty.
Literally.
He's the governor of New York State. And I just heard this on the way in. I thought it was interesting. He was giving people tips about how not to pass the virus around.
Don't shake hands. Don't hug.
tell the other person so you don't offend them.
Oh, well, that's very nice at the end. I'm not hugging you because I think you might be a carrier of a killer disease.
Trust me.
I don't mean to offend you. I don't mean to offend you.
Where does that accent come from? There's only four people in New York State who sound like that. Him, his dad, and his brother.
Yeah, it's just the Cuomo accent. Whatever, yeah. Where do they
I'm
come
the Cuomo.
From? They come from, like, Scotland? Where do they come from? I have no idea. What is their background? Obviously, Cuomo. They're Italian. Scotland. All right, Eric.
Well, they immigrated there
I'm
first.
I'm sorry. I'm seeing the sun for the first time in months. It's obviously having
fire
an effect.
In the sky?
What is that thing?
It burns when I look at it.
Yeah, let's hear it again. It is kind of an odd, it's not really an accent. It's just it's affected. It's not an accent.
Don't shake hands. Don't hug. Tell the other person so you don't offend them.
Yeah, I don't offend you, but I think you might be carrying a vicious disease.
don't touch me.
Don't hug me. Can you do the voice?
No, I couldn't do his father either. It was very tough.
His father had a little more drawn out.
It was more Kennedy-like. Yeah. Out in Matawan, the shining house on the hill.
All right. Before we take this break, Elizabeth Warren did drop out of the presidential race.
I will not be
stop
running.
For 1 second.
I
would have lost my bet. Somebody should have got... I didn't hear... I thought,
bet you.
Did you?
Yeah.
You
play
yeah.
back the tape. Jared.
First of all... We don't have tape. There's zeros and ones.
Hold on.
Secondly, I got something to say about money and the transfer of money and bets. And I got people to... This lady took $1,000 from me and just walked away. I mean, just walked. She just took the money and ran. You ever take the money and run?
Yeah.
She took my money and she ran.
Here, Autumn, I'll reverse it for you.
Right to the... Yeah. She ran right to the ice cream parlor. So I lost my bet, or at least I don't know. I didn't watch the whole Liz Warren suspending my campaign statement, but I expected that it would start with "so," and it started with kind of a sigh, from what I've heard.
I will not be running for president in 2020.
I'm exhausted.
But I guarantee I will stay in the fight. For the hardworking folks across this country who've gotten the short end of the stick over and over.
Can I tell you, these people, this Elizabeth Warren, is so willing to take on the cape of hero. It's really, it annoys the hell out of me. I saw a headline yesterday. I think about every little girl... Whoever came up to me. Well, you really have no problem seeing yourself as some sort of deity. Because you ran and came in fifth place.
I'm taking some notes from North Korea.
Yeah.
build
statues of me.
Honor their leaders there.
Yeah, all the little girls who I inspired to know that they could come in at least fifth place in a primary. I was trying to think. Like, I don't think that actual great people like MLK talked about how great they were all the time. But we have people now like Elizabeth Warren, or even like the people who write Star Wars will come out. Oh, we are so great for what we're doing and letting little kids who are different. Like, you know what? If that's true, go ahead and live a good long life. And after you're gone, let the historians look into it and let them proclaim it. But we have so many people online, the social media people. Oh, look at me. I'm a mother, and I also run my own business, and I also do. I'm great. I'm great. Elizabeth Warren, she's so great. She feels so wonderful about all the little girls who now know they can come in fifth place in a primary for president of the United States. No.
Good luck, everybody.
Let's get the first woman as president of the United States. And if that's a person who's a decent person, they don't really talk about it. And they have there, maybe they get reelected, and then they live a good long life, and then they're gone. And 100 years later, let historians step in and decide. And let historians proclaim, but we are so easy now just to deify ourselves. It's like, oh, I'm great. What I did was wonderful, and I am not going to stop working for those people who are below me, you know, the little people, and because I know that if I wasn't here, they wouldn't have a shot. Wow, you really see something when you look in the mirror, don't you?
Why won't you?
I'm really looking forward to reading about myself in the history books.
Yes.
Why not support Tulsi Gabbard? There still is a woman running for president.
She's not a woman. She's a conservative.
She's a conservative. That's not a woman. She's not with us.
Yeah. She's not with the cause. Don't you know from the left, being a woman is not a gender. It's a political philosophy.
Oh.
It's like being black is not a race. It's a political philosophy. So if you're on the left, Clarence Thomas isn't black because he doesn't think the way you're supposed to think in order to be anointed actually black by the left. Sorry, it was a little rant. What else do we have here? Yeah. Let's see. I want to see Warren. She's complaining about the Bernie bros. Everybody thinks that she's going to endorse Bernie because their philosophies are so much the same, but she was harassed by these Bernie bros, and she seems like she's taking it personally.
It's not who I want to be as a Democrat. It's not who I want to be as an American. And to the extent I have any power to control that, I do what I can, and I call on others to do the same.
Oh, well, hey, Liz called on you, Autumn. Make sure you do the same. You
know,
you're part of her cause, whether you like it or not. Oh, and then Sanders comes in and says, hey, no, to heck with the Bernie bros. I mean, he's right. If politically you line up with her, you're going to be more toward Bernie than Biden.
There is no question that her agenda. What she fought for in the campaign was far closer to what I am fighting for than what Joe Biden believes in.
Much closer.
The music's on. When we come back, did Trump have a Fox town hall?
Yes, he did. He had a town hall last night.
Can we quickly squeeze it in? He's playing a cool game here, an interesting game. Let's put in 18 real fast. He starts talking about how she hurt Bernie.
Bernie Sanders would have won 5, 6, 7 states. It would have won Minnesota. It would have won at least another 2 or 3 states. So when you look at it, she did him no favors. That was not a good friendship.
Yeah. People say he's not a politician, but he knows what he's doing. Bernie is a different kind of populist, but he's a populist, and Trump knows he can pick up some of those votes, so he's going to go on. He's going to be the standard bearer of the Bernie grievance crowd more than Bernie Sanders. By way of reminder, the president lands at Dobbins at 3:30 this afternoon. He's going to make his way to the CDC. Then when that's over, they're going to have to make his way back, which means you need to be tuned in right here. Jared points to the call, the numbers. I know where I work.
You've been on a lot of stations in your life, Eric.
I certainly have. I may have forgotten, ladies and gentlemen. Right here at 96 Rock. We'll keep. Oh, I'm sorry. No, I
said 93.
Yeah, bye. Yeah. The zoo crew will get you. No, it's the 95.5 WSB. Just keep it right here.
Smiling Mark McKay will be above it all.
I have got an awful lot of audio. Too much that we're going to leave some on the table here, but I want to make sure. I like to provide a public service. I myself am a libertarian, but I like to provide a public service to people on the left and on the right sometimes. This one, I have to say, warning. Here's an alert. Warning, Democrats. Warning. 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 I'm warning my Democrat friends. Everybody's gathered around the Joe Biden fire. He's our man. He's a lot stronger. I agree. All right, please. That's give me a headache. I agree that he's a better candidate than Bernie, because Bernie, I believe, is about as close to communist as you can be without being a communist. When at that point, it doesn't matter. So Biden has run for president 3 times. Eric von Haessler has been alive to witness them all. The first time was in 1988. And, you know, we always hear the story that he was forced to pull out of that race because of plagiarism, which there's a guy named Neil Kinnock, who I believe was the Labour Party leader, and he was going around England campaigning, and basically he was talking about how he was from, you know, the industrial part, and he's a working class kid, and all that, what he had to do, and it turned out that Biden was given the same speech in America. It had lifted it completely. But there was more. This is, what is this from? You found this.
I can't source it. I tried to find it. Somebody put together just kind of like a little montage from 1988.
This has to be 88, because I'm looking at the news, and it's
Sam Donaldson didn't have gray hair yet.
Yeah, and also he didn't run again until 2004. Right. So this is, warning to Democrats, this was a piece Did it look like NBC News, this particular one?
ABC.
ABC News.
It's actually all of them.
All of them. Okay, from when from 1988, say news coverage.
Yes.
When nightly news mattered, when Joe Biden's first run.
I went to law school on a full academic scholarship, the only one in my class to have a full academic scholarship. Went back to law school and, in fact, ended up in the top half of my class. I was the outstanding student in the political science department at the end of my year. I graduated with 3 degrees from undergraduate school and 165 credits, only needed 123 credits.
Biden now concedes he did not graduate in the top half of his law school class, that he does not have 3 degrees from college, and that he was not named outstanding political science student in college.
Newsweek says Biden actually went to school on a half scholarship, ended up near the bottom of his class, and won only 1 degree, not 3.
Joe Biden ranked 76th in a class of 85 at the University of Syracuse Law School. I mean, this guy comes off this whole thing as a flyweight.
Now Biden says Newsweek is right. His memory had failed him.
Warning! Democrats! The ghost of Biden past may very well come back to haunt you. How difficult will it be to make commercials? I'm just warning. Look, I don't have any skin in this game. I don't even know which goofball the libertarians have decided that I'm going to vote for this year. I think it's
great,
though.
At the mercy of whoever.
Well, given the kind of show that we do where we go after everybody, we just have fun, you know, and I realize that they all have feet of clay, even if members of my audience don't. I think it's great that I vote for the goofball libertarian because I do my civic duty. I go and I vote. You know that I'm not trying to steer you one way or another. As I've said many times, I don't know who's going to win in November. All I know is, whoever it is, I'm going to make fun of them, because that's my lane. My job is to keep reminding you that they're just people. And this person has a past. I mean, we talk now about his gaffes, right?
Right.
Yeah.
That he's old and maybe he's losing it. This is 1988.
He's claiming that his memory failed him.
Yeah, back then.
That's not a memory. That's a created.
You know,
memory.
I think it's worth one more. I think it's worth one more listen.
I agree.
This is 1988 coverage.
I went to law school on a full academic scholarship, the only one in my class to have a full academic scholarship. Went back to law school and, in fact, ended up in the top half of my class. I was the outstanding student in the political science department at the end of my year. I graduated with 3 degrees from undergraduate school and 165 credits. Only needed 123 credits.
Biden now concedes he did not graduate in the top half of his law school class, that he does not have 3 degrees from college, and that he was not named outstanding political science student in college.
Newsweek says Biden actually went to school on a half scholarship, ended up near the bottom of his class, and won only 1 degree, not 3.
Joe Biden ranked 76th in a class of 85 at the University of Syracuse Law School. I mean, this guy comes off this whole thing as a flyweight.
Now Biden says Newsweek is right. His memory had failed him.
His memory failed him back in 1988.
He's like, oh, yeah, that's right. No, it was actually the opposite of everything I just said.
That's what you know what happens? You know how some people are dyslexic with words and letters?
Yeah.
Biden is dyslexic with events.
Yeah.
So sometimes he thinks the exact...
Corn Pop was a great dude.
Yeah. Hey, what do we know? Hey,
Corn Pop was a bad dude.
Perhaps he was a great dude.
ABC has discovered that Corn Pop was indeed a good dude who went out of his way to help his community.
The children in the pool did not like his leg.
No, turns out. And you know what? Even this is a lie.
Go to Joe 303. 3-0.
I tell you, the guy can't.
It's I was an Eagle Scout in art school. I was the first person ever in the United States to repaint the Mona Lisa by hand. And look, hey, let me tell you, they hung it up in every museum in the United States, and I followed around with it and I signed it.
You were the first man on the moon, as I recall.
Back in 1969, they said, hey, Joe, why don't you fly up on the moon? So I walked on the moon. I didn't even wear a helmet. And then I came back to Earth and I got my dental degree. I graduated in the top 5. One time Barack had a sore tooth. I said, hey, let me look at that, Barack. And I drilled it right there in the White House because I had my own little dental outfit going.
You know.
Hey, I invented the comb.
You invented the comb.
Wow.
Yeah, I invented the comb.
Yeah. People say you stole it from the guy who invented the brush, though. It says,
hey, the brush has a bunch of different things. It's like, I'll put like, hey, look. You take a stick and you put a bunch of wires and let your brush. I took a piece of wood. And I made, you know, I put in, I said, hey, Amy Klobuchar, go eat a salad with this.
this is something Tim and I, this little weird thing that happened this morning with this Brian Williams report.
Yeah.
So Brian Williams on MSNBC last night, this is a claim of math that should have been checked. So this is one of those things where you pick stuff up from social media, you don't get it checked. And so, but there's something very strange about this. It's messing. I have it here. Mind messing. Do I have enough time here to play this? Do I have one minute to play? Okay. Thank you, Alan. Is it a machine gun?
No.
Not a machine gun?
Not a machine gun.
Somebody tweeted recently that actually with the money he spent, he could have given every American $1 million.
I got it. Let's put it up on the screen. When I read it tonight on social media, it kind of all became clear. Bloomberg spent $500 million on ads, U.S. population, $327 million. Don't tell us if you're ahead of us on the math. He could have given each American $1 million and have had lunch money left over. It's an incredible way of putting it.
It's an incredible way of putting it. It's true. It's disturbing.
But it's not true. This is weird. I can't figure, there's something in my mind that makes it sound like it's true, but it's not, right? He would give everybody less than $2.
Right.
So it's very easy for me to understand that let's just say there's 330 million people in America, that if you gave each one of them $1, you'd end up spending $330 million.
Correct.
That's easy for my brain to understand. But if you tell me if you gave 330 million people $1 million apiece, it still seems to me like that adds up. Why?
I don't know.
It doesn't. It would be $1 for 333 million.
Correct.
But it still seems like if you tell, if you gave $1 million to 330 million people, you'd spend 300. There's something weird in my brain, but you're experiencing this as well, Tim.
When I read that people were arguing with it, I thought, why are you arguing? Oh, yeah, I get it.
No, right. Yeah. So I get where Brian Williams went wrong, but he needs to pass that around the office, not just pick it up off of social media.
No, it says it right there on the tweet.
Well, you think Brian Williams, he's over there on timeout over on MSNBC because of telling that big lie of a story about being shot at in a helicopter during the war. And so you'd think that he will have been, you know, once bitten, twice shy. You think he would check his figures rather than just taking some stupid math from social media. And I'll play this again and listen to the lady who he's talking to, it just shows how disturbing things are in this country, except that the math couldn't be more wrong.
Somebody tweeted recently that
Somebody. Good sourcing.
Actually, with the money he spent, he could have given every American $1 million.
Got it. Let's put it.
By the way, they're talking about Mike Bloomberg and how much money he spent.
Somebody tweeted recently that actually, with the money he spent, he could have given every American $1 million.
Got it. Let's put it up on the screen. When I read it tonight on social media, it kind of all became clear. Bloomberg spent $500 million on ads, U.S. population, $327 million. Don't tell us if you're ahead of us on the math. He could have given each American $1 million and have had lunch money left over. It's an incredible way of putting it.
It's an incredible way of putting it. It's true.
It's true.
It's disturbing.
Yeah. It's disturbing. So it's not true. In fact, he would have given each American $1.52.
$1.52.
Yeah. And not a million. So hold on. If it's 327 million people in the nation, if Bloomberg would have given each of us $1 million, it would have cost him $327 trillion. That's the real math.
It doesn't.
What I love about it is you got to remember, most people are not in the news industry. This is something that I learned early on. Sometimes reporters would come into the morning show. The Falcons are going to the Super Bowl, so we were doing a contest. Come up with your Falcons, your best Falcons song, or some kind of contest. And when they came in, I realized they were just telling us where to be, where to stand, what to say. They walked in the door with the story in their head, right? And you would never know that except when I'm watching the news and I watch that story, I know that I work there, I do that, and that did not represent the reality. And you may work at a dental office or you may work at an accounting thing where the news comes in and you know in your situation, wow, they really, really got that wrong. Well, this is another one of those windows of opportunity. When you watch on television, not only hearing people give you figures that are not true, but then responding to them in such, oh, it's highly disturbing.
It's just disturbing. Yeah. It's a problem. But I did the math also, and a lot of people retweeted it, so I definitely
right. So it must be right.
I guess it's the new math. So, well, will they come back on? Will they be apologetic? Absolutely not. It's just like you make a sports prediction. It doesn't come true. You come back the next week. You have the same confidence. You predict the next games. That's the way that it goes. But I mean, did the Falcons win? No, they did not win. So, I mean, you have to look at these little things. These are the people. We're going to put it up on the board. How many hands did it have to go through before it got up on the board that no one sourced the math? I know it's weird because if somebody tells you you could give $1 million to all 330 million people and only spend 330 million, it sounds right. But in reality, you'd only give $1.52. And we figured this out. But they don't over at MSNBC.
Somebody tweeted recently that actually with the money he spent, he could have given every American $1 million.
I got it. Let's put it up on the screen.
Let's put it up on the screen.
When I read it tonight on social media, it kind of all became clear.
Yeah, I
Bloomberg
didn't think
spent $500 million on ads. U.S. population, 327 million. Don't tell us if you're ahead of us on the math. He could have given each American $1 million and have had lunch money left over. It's an incredible way of putting it.
It's true. It's disturbing.
Okay, if it's not true, which it's not true, each of us would have gotten $1.52. Can we assume then that it's not disturbing?
No, it is.
It's disturbing, and it's true because it's disturbing. It's disturbing because it's true.
Thank you.
Yeah.
What if it's not true, though?
It's still
then
disturbing.
Then it's not disturbing.
No,
well, that's what
it
I'm
is.
Saying. So that's
I mean,
what
it
I'm,
is.
Huh?
It is.
I mean,
people are
whatever.
Confused.
Let's put it up on the board.
All right, listen, we got to go,
now
people.
It's legitimate.
The music is going, and this my producer is pretending to drive. Means he wants me to tell you that we may have sunny days, but we got the president coming in, and he's going to land at Dobbins at 3:30, make his way to the CDC. Then when it's over, he's going to make his way back, keep it right here. We will smile at Mark McKay. We'll be up above it all. And he will divert you and get you around it. Me, I'm going to beat it. Get the heck out of here. But not quite yet. Got to go over and do the Podcast 30. You want to join us over there, go to the Von Haessler Doctrine Facebook page, WSB Radio Facebook page. Click on the red box. Voila. You're watching us do the Podcast 30. Thanks for listening to the Von Haessler Doctrine Podcast. Remember, you can hear the show every weekday from 9 to noon right here on 95.5 WSB, Atlanta's news and talk. All right, Podcast 30 time. You got another half hour in you, Andrews?
All right.
Got another half hour in you?
Sure.
Huh?
Yeah.
There's Tim Andrews. J-Rad on tunes. Autumn Fisher with her sexy flatulence. It's Autumn.
Jimmy Durante over there.
Yeah.
Mrs. Calabash.
All right, Jared. Jared loves the Jimmy Durante.
Oh, God, he was talking about him all morning.
Yeah. What part of Jimmy Durante's body was he famous for?
Oh, his nose, of course.
Oh, look at that.
So,
he knows that because of cartoons.
You knew that?
How do you know that?
I honestly took a guess.
Oh, yeah, he's the big schnoz.
No, okay, good.
Had no talent that I could ever.
A big nose.
He had a big nose.
He
walked around. He'd walk around. Do this thing with his arms.
Smile. When the world is something.
He's the narrator of Frosty the Snowman.
Yeah, that's right.
So you've seen Frosty the Snowman, right, Jared?
Yes.
Yeah.
So the cartoon big nose guy. That's Jimmy Durante.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's his voice.
So does he sing
Frosty? Frosty was wondering what it was bothering Frosty something.
As a kid, I loved the one song where he's parading through the street There's that one part of obviously Frosty the Snowman where he's parading through the street. It's like down through the village.
You mean the song Frosty the Snowman?
That's that movie Frosty the
Snowman. Right, but it's that one part
of that
song.
That is Jimmy Durante. He goes, Frosty the Snowman. No, I know the part you're talking about.
Come here and there.
It's the hilarity of the cop just waving the kids across the street and not at first noticing that one of them is a snowman, not a human. Then he does a double take. Then he swallows his whistle. Now that's some hilarity. Nothing better than the double take. Not funny if you notice that it's not a human in the first shot. Funny that you let it go by you and then go, huh?
That's a cool old trope.
Yeah.
You know, like the one where the homeless guy is, you know, he sees something crazy. And he looks at his bottle of whatever.
Yeah. And
he's
I must have. Oh, yeah. He throws it. I'm done drinking. Yeah. These hallucinations have just gone too far. Yeah. I'm done with that. What were we going to talk about here? A couple of things. One is, here we are on Friday.
Friday.
Shut up. Here we are on Friday. And I'm beginning to realize that I try to lead by example. I'm a capitalist. And so if I want things to happen, I will shake the money around to make it happen. One is, I wanted my friend Autumn to, I brought her in for the sexy, you know. Mm-hmm. She immediately started having kids and stopped caring, you know. But I brought her in, you know, I had a little sexy to the show. And so I said, hey, you know what, I'll challenge her. I lost some weight. I feel better. I care about my friend Autumn Fisher. And so I challenged her. $1,000, I says. You lose 10 pounds in a month. And this was my fear, that she would lose the 10 pounds, I'd give her the $1,000, and then, you know, it's just back to party town. And she
that's not true.
Didn't I think I continually said, if you keep, lose 3 more pounds a month or whatever.
$300.
Yeah. And I don't think she cares about that, because I haven't heard any updates. There's no challenge really. In the last 2 weeks, I think that she's had, you know, a couple of frivolous meals that had nothing to do with actual nutrition or sustenance, but more like, it would just make me feel better to eat these things right now. And that's what I'm trying to get her out of. But she took my money and she ran. I can't get that $1,000 back.
$10.99 or so she has to pay taxes.
Yeah, that's what I'm going to do.
So I had something happen where I needed something. Uh-huh. And it influenced not my appetite, but my drive to eat.
Yes.
And so I had a lot of trouble with that. But I'm kind of through that now.
Okay.
And I'm back on the wagon.
You're back on the wagon.
Yeah.
Going a little slower.
Yeah, it's a larger wagon than it used to be.
Dragon.
No, but I mean,
I'm junk in the trunk.
I'm not killing myself over it, but I'm aware of it. You know,
I'm even putting pressure on my wife, and just it's hard. My wife is very small. No, I don't do that. Would never say such a thing. But she, unlike me, she's not tall. So she has to nearly starve herself. She works out a lot, but it didn't matter at one point. Mm. It was just like, didn't
working
matter.
Working out really is only this really like 20% of weight loss, some really small percentage.
You know what she did? And this is weird for me because I'm so tall and I hide this stuff. My wife's only, she says she's 5'2". She's probably like 5'1", or maybe. And she would drink like one martini like a night. Like at night, she liked to have a martini or something, right? And she cut that out, and it's helping her lose weight. Now, to me, one martini would be nothing.
See, that's the thing.
Nothing.
That's what I was trying to tell you to begin with.
Right?
Is that it's hard for me. Mm. It's hard for some, you know, it's hard. You're only 5'2".
Yeah.
It's hard to lose weight.
You're not 5'2", are you? You're taller.
Yes, I'm 5'2".
You're the same height as my wife, or she's lying. She's really 5'1" or something.
She might be a little bit shorter than me.
Yeah, she's always said 5'2". I never really believed it. But I didn't want to push it, you know.
She's 5'1" and 12 inches.
That's right. Also, another thing, another challenge that seems to be coming to an end here with money and capitalism. And it's been a busy week, but he knew it was going to be a busy week. This Jared Yamamoto, I told him, $100 if by the end of the week My desk is put, and this is, by the way, this was not a, I'm the boss, I'm putting this on you. This was, I like doing this stuff. I love putting together a desk, and
I do enjoy that
stuff.
So
I try to.
I actually enjoy when I buy new furniture, if it is like a furniture that you assemble like that, which is the type of furniture that I can afford right now.
Yeah.
I'm with you, man. I'm so patient in putting shelves together and stuff.
It stimulates your brain in a different way. I mean, it's not challenging.
It's a hobby of mine.
I enjoy it.
Yeah, me too.
Well, I this guy who enjoys it, I said $100 if it's done by the end of the week.
Well, I've had things to take care of in my personal life.
You knew what you had to do this week, and you knew it was going to be a rough week.
I would have done it for 50.
You can hear me?
Still can.
Yeah, but here's the thing.
I'm busy today.
I can't get you... I can't get you and the quitting smoking. I might come in there and find holes in the wall.
You don't smoke inside.
No. You're getting frustrated.
I'm very calm when it comes to putting stuff together.
I don't need to find out.
Don't listen to her lies.
I'll come back on Monday morning and there'll be blood in the hallways.
Everybody knows that Tim is the epitome of patience.
Yes.
And controlling one's anger.
Well, yeah.
What will happen is Tim will commit and then you'll have 3/4 of a desk done. And then, he'll leave early.
The reason I gave you till Monday is I thought, well, if he doesn't get done by Friday, he can come in the weekend. No. I don't see that happening.
Well,
not this weekend. We have sunshine out this weekend. Soccer tomorrow.
Yeah, we have to drink a bunch.
Wait. So if it was raining, you would come in and do it?
Maybe. I would consider.
What does $100 mean to you? Nothing?
That's not true.
Come in early, 6 in the morning on Saturday. You get yourself, you'll know the first $100 of drinks and brunch are on me.
That's right, on Sunday.
That is tempting. Mm-hmm. I think I would do it Sunday afternoon if I had any time. But I have a birthday party tonight, then I got Atlanta United tomorrow.
What socialist
friend
is getting
Atlanta?
Socialist?
What's one of your socialist friends?
Not a socialist. It's one of my good friends.
How long you think you'd do brunch
on Sunday?
Works
in the film industry here in Atlanta.
How long you think you would be doing brunch on Sunday while you're not putting my desk together?
I'm doing brunch tomorrow for a long time.
I've never done brunch in my life. I don't even know what it means to sit in one place and eat
lunch. But Jared, what time is brunch?
$5.
Brunch is like 11 to 4.
They go from like 11 to 4.
Yeah, brunch is going to be 11 to 4 and then the United game.
So wake up at a normal time like 9.
But that would be
run
eight.
Into the station,
yeah.
Put it together, and then know, like you said, that $100 is going to be applied to your.
What if you give me an extension through midnight on Monday night? Because you didn't specify what time on Monday.
No, you hit me with a technicality.
11:59 p.m.
Yeah, I could probably get it done Monday afternoon.
I think that it needs to be Monday midnight, like Sunday midnight.
But he never specified. He just said Monday.
Look, if I could have this thing done by next Tuesday, I will take that.
Okay.
I just want to.
I think you should lower the price. I think it should be like.
Yeah, but then he's not going to do it. No, he's not going to do it. Now I'm competing with brunches and birthday parties and.
I just have things to do this weekend.
All these things,
and it's going to be sunny outside. I'm excited to go walk around.
You sit on your ass from 11 to 4 in one place.
We do not sit in one place. We brunch in many different places.
How do you do that?
Easy. You bounce around. Yeah, you keep walking.
But I mean, do you have to restart the brunch everywhere you go?
Usually, get a small bite here and there, get a couple drinks, and you go to the next place, and then you bounce around.
Brunch bites.
Yeah, brunch bites, exactly.
What would this guy have done had he not lived in the era of the Beltline?
I mean, I was in the era without the Beltline.
He would have gone to a mall.
Yeah.
Oh, we just go here, then we go here.
And Cheese Julius.
Then we go to Friendly's.
Auntie Anne's or whatever the hell it is.
Well, it's a good way to justify me moving around. If I'm going to drink like that, if I'm moving around, at least I don't feel as guilty.
Yeah. So
afterwards.
So many rules.
That's not true.
They got beer.
Jared's party rules.
If we're enjoying a place, and we'll stay one place
how
longer
than
the other.
How many is we?
I think this weekend we have it's a relatively small brunch group. It's six of us.
How the hell do you brunch for five? How do you do anything for 5 hours?
Because you're drinking and
you're coordinating with all those people.
I haven't seen a lot of these folks in a while.
Mm. At what point are
good
you?
Good time with friends.
At what point are you S-faced by like 1:32?
Honestly, I'll probably, because of how little sleep I've gotten this week, I'll probably be S-faced by like 12:30. It'll be like an hour and a half.
And you're going to keep drinking until 4.
Oh, yeah. By the time I get that Atlanta United game without Joseph Martinez playing,
and
I'm going to be yelling the whole time.
Who's the striker?
He'll be one of those guys with fireworks in the stands.
Yeah. Oh, I'm in the club section, too. I'm excited.
Ooh, they're taking care of you.
Yeah, they're taking care of me.
Jared, let me ask you a question.
Yeah, of course.
What's it like after you drink that much? Because I think that you're in this sort of window where you are looking to drink like you used to and be able to recover like you used to, but then the next morning kicks you in the ass. And that really helped me stop getting so crazy and do that thing that I always wanted to do, which was just like a couple of drinks to you know, lubricate the conversation and lubricate the night, not to like drench myself. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, it's totally about maintaining. You want to stay at that happy level
for a while.
That's
not what I'm saying, Jared. That's not
what I'm
saying.
But you're not maintaining. You're getting S-faced.
No, he's going.
It just depends on what crowd I'm with. If I'm with a crowd that's not
Jared,
turning
I'm not
up,
asking that. Listen, what I'm asking is the next morning, how do you feel?
It cannot
right
be
now,
as easy to,
right,
to as
recover.
It was to recover as it was when you were 19.
You know, I it's funny. People say that. People are like, are your hangover times worse? And I'd say no,
you know
at
what?
This point, which is dangerous.
He's the Tom Brady of drinking.
Yeah.
he's able to keep that game going well into.
Do you have
I don't
any...
get the hangovers, but my stomach does. I will say this. This is something that has changed. My
a lot
stomach,
more vomiting than there used to be.
Not necessarily more
Did
vomiting.
Did you not vomit
Diarrhea
in the last couple of weeks?
Morning?
I vomited when I went to Nashville, I guess, a couple months ago. But that was the first time I had vomited in years.
Okay.
But
you know, my son vomited, and my youngest, he's always bragging about the fact that no matter how much he parties, he doesn't vomit. Then he called his mother a couple weekends ago to ask how to get vomit out of a carpet because he didn't make it to the bathroom. And I saw him over it, and I, you know, as you do with your kids, I pointed my finger at him and went, ah. And he said, it's worse than that. I was actually, right before that happened, I was bragging about how I never vomit.
Oh, no, he had that moment. Yeah. Oh, man. No, I think I think after a while, I've built this kind of defense system where, especially with liquor lately, like if I have too much, I'm like, okay, my stomach's kind of going. I need to go
what
back to beer.
Your stomach is going. Does that mean like you start getting the runs?
No. I'm just
because I have stomach I trouble after I drink too much the night.
I get full, especially with liquor, and I'm like, okay, all right, I gotta stop.
By the way, once again, Autumn, bring in the sexy.
Yeah.
Don't you guys get that?
Get what? Diarrhea after drinking?
Yeah.
No.
Really?
I mean, not usually.
I don't drink anymore, so I don't know.
Yeah, I only really get that one as a result of sickness or food or something.
Oh, I get it after drinking too much.
Don't need to know that. You're a girl.
I also get hemorrhoids after white
wine. No. Girls don't have stuff like that.
I mean, they're always in there. Yeah. They get upset.
When?
No.
Yeah, anytime I drink white wine.
Maybe this is sexing up some part of the crowd.
Do you use Preparation H?
Yeah, sometimes.
Nice.
Just a little, you know.
My name's Henry.
Wipes
if it hurts,
or
I'll like be your friend.
All right.
Ointment.
Enough of the sex talk.
I got them, especially when I was pregnant, and then they never went away.
Oh boy, it just gets better and better.
I got some.
And you know
bands.
When I knew I was about to give birth when my mucus plug came out.
Mm-hmm.
And
can I have it?
I can send you a picture of it.
I don't want a picture.
Mucus plug.
I want the plug.
Yeah, I framed it and put it in my.
You know what I'm saying?
It's like a pacifier.
I have been drinking today. But the
pacifier.
Yeah, we open up a trunk. When my kids are like in their 20s, like, look, your mucus plug. I show it to their boyfriend.
I haven't been drinking today at all, but I'm finding that this
today?
Conversation is turning my stomach.
Yeah.
Chris
Does it
Chandler,
help if I let you know some details about my hemorrhoids?
No. I don't
They're not on
details.
The outside.
No. I don't like any details. I don't
They're
like
in there.
I don't...
You know, so from the outside, it's like a Monet. From the outside, from far away, it's fine. If you get up too close, then it's
Like Ferris Bueller. You're too close. You can't see
the good
stuff.
Okay, I'm completely disgusted. So where has this ended up? You are going to try to lose weight, and you are going to try to do my desk.
Yeah, and also, I found a
and
couple
no
of good...
If you come in here over the weekend with your girlfriend, no hanky-panky.
We'll
hey,
try
once
our
that
best.
Desk is built, that's a nice little surface.
Hey, you do have the nice couch, too, in the office.
Yeah, okay. That's already got plenty of stains on it, but this glass-top desk, I do not want broke in that way, all right?
Hey, listen, Dave Baker already did stuff in that office
before.
Oh,
yeah, Dave Baker
you
used to have
that. You're on the walls.
Dave Baker.
I already suggest you paint it.
Dave Baker and I still have the... He still has the... He will not give me the key. He used to have my office. And we still have that.
Oh, he's keeping his own key?
Yeah.
You don't want to take a glow light in there, I can tell you.
No, it's like to a, like,
luminol.
We try to pretend as old men that we're still in college, like, if you ever see a sock on the on the doorknob, just keep walking. That's my Dave Baker.
It hurts my voice to do it too long, but if I get it down, I can do it. So tomorrow on the show, we got Tom DeGregorio. We're going to talk about all the rain that we've had here and if your basement's flooded. And then I'll probably argue with the news lady a little bit and we'll insult each other and then go back and forth.
Who they do the, that. I love it.
I know. Well, it's fine when the news
person... Well, because she's real sassy on the weekend.
Yeah, she's funny.
Is it, who,
yeah.
Is it Cheryl Castro?
No.
Or who is it?
No,
I hear when I'm in my car.
Oh, it's Robin.
Robin.
Yeah, which Robin definitely plays.
Oh, okay. Very good.
Why don't you get back to doing the news?
Why don't you do your show?
Why don't you get back to doing the news?
I like that. Dave Baker's a very funny guy. That was one of the initial surprises when I came in this building. Because, of course, I'd heard Dave Baker. I knew him as the home fix-it guy, whatever. I did not know how funny he was. You know, he told me the other day at Pete Spriggs' going away party that... he's in a movie where he carries Raven around. And it was a movie I'd heard of.
Raven who?
Raven as
from
in...
From That's So Raven?
Yeah, is that Raven Simone? Is that who that is?
Okay.
The last girl in the Cosby? When the little girl got too big to be the little girl, they brought in the other little girl, and that was Raven on the Cosby Show?
Mm.
And I was talking about that, and then Dave Baker said that there's a movie that she's in, and he's in it, and I guess he carries her around or something. I don't know if he was joking or if he was telling me the truth, but he said the name of the movie.
That's a classic Dave Baker conversation there. You don't know if he's joking.
Yeah, I had heard the name of the movie, and I know he used to do comedy and stuff, so maybe he landed this role. I have no idea. I have no idea.
Raven Simone. Is that with a Y?
Yeah, I believe it's with a Y. I don't know. I don't know.
It is.
Just put that, Raven.
How about David Baker?
What movies has she been in? I mean, how many movies could she have been in? I would go there.
Well, I know that her...
I think she's got a bigger IMDb footprint than Dave Baker.
Well, her career was kind of halted because she got pregnant young, if I'm correct. I think I'm correct on that one. She got pregnant young.
Just go ahead and pass along misinformation.
Well, that's why I'm saying I think.
Was it a movie or a TV show?
It could have been a TV movie. I'm not sure.
Well,
Princess Diaries?
No, text Dave Baker and ask him.
You want to see a picture of Monica Perez I got?
No.
You sure? I'll text it to you.
Dave Baker sends me things sometimes.
I got a folder.
One time he sent me something, and I went, okay.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
I bet I've seen that.
Little rascals?
He had told me a story about an inappropriate piece of video that had been sent to him, and... I think we had some sort of photo of me at that time. This is a few years ago. And I was like, it was like from my back, but you could see that I was gazing out upon things.
Yeah.
And it was during Clark's Christmas Kids, and he was laughing about it. And he had told me about this inappropriate video that had been sent to him, a still from it. And then I said, I want that new thing to be just me looking out, and you can put anything you want in front of it. And Eric's gazing upon it. And sure enough, when I got home, he had me gazing upon the inappropriate video still. Am I the only one who has him on my phone? Do I have to be the one who texts him?
No, I haven't. I'm just sitting here listening to your story.
And why don't you
I don't
just,
have his number.
Well, you don't need his number.
What movie? Really? I'll text him. You're the host.
I want to text him a picture of what happens after I drink white wine.
No. Just add,
I'll look at it.
Ask him the name of the movie that he's in with Raven.
Name of the porn.
I had heard of them. Why did Autumn just send me a thing?
Oh, this was before when you were giving me guff about my diet. I saw you eating cake.
Yeah, I had a bad day today. I ate
You had a donut too.
Hey, rat.
Oh,
no, it's not a rat. It's not a rat. You know. Hey, look, if I put it all back on, and it's a big laugh, right?
But
it's not going to happen.
I told Eric, I said, you had a good week of shows. Great week of shows.
I had a great week of shows. You guys had a pretty good week of shows. You put that all together, that's a very good week of shows.
So basically, you're saying
you said you carried us this week, huh?
Yeah, I always carry everybody.
You're so mean.
Am I?
Yes.
No.
You say that too much.
No.
It hurts.
I'm not that.
Like, when you say it once, it's funny, and then you say it again, and you play along, and then when you keep saying it, it's like,
Let's just get to the words that are used here. I agree with Tim. I am not mean. What did you say? Hate-filled.
Yes.
I would agree. Hate-filled. Yeah. Not mean.
Oh.
Hate-filled, perhaps.
So wait, is that better?
I believe it. Hate-filled, because at least that shows commitment.
I don't think you're
hate-filled.
Really.
Filled
that's
up.
How you feel, and I can't deny how you feel.
I'm all filled up with hate.
I just call it general disdain. That's what I try to get. General disdain. It's a syndrome.
Oh, we had a great week of shows.
Folliculitis.
Yeah. Hey, you guys, come on, compare me to other people that have been in charge of shows.
Don't put that sweetheart logic on me, Ricky Bobby.
I'm a sweetheart.
Yes, of course you are. Sometimes I give credit. You pull pigtails too hard.
You guys don't know how many times I go and talk to people above me. I'm on my team. I'm worried about me. I put my team in front.
I agree with that 100%.
Why hasn't Tim gotten a Matt Award then?
Because he's not in charge of the Matt Awards.
No, I said don't give Tim a Matt Award.
That's what do everything else for me.
Suck up like Jared over
that
here.
That one.
I haven't gotten one in like a year now.
No, you've gotten
that's because they were here. Nobody on my team gets a man award.
I see.
Which is the
I got one.
You're not on my team.
Why not? I do, boys.
Here's why. In order to get a Mad Award, for people who don't know, it's called Making a Difference. You get a $100 bill.
And you get a medallion.
A medallion. $100 bill, y'all. That you wear. And it has to be somebody, one of your superiors has to nominate you for the Matt Award. So I would be the person on an everyday basis. So I would say I would nominate you. Or I guess back
Drew
then,
now.
Pete could have, Drew can now. But even I would go to them. But here's the problem. Here's the problem. If I nominate one of you, then the rotisserie starts.
Then we split it.
And I have to nominate.
Come on.
I get kickbacks. Yeah. Then I have to nominate all of you over time, or else I've got problems on the good ship Von Haessler Doctrine. I don't want to see that.
Ship
what I would rather do, what I would rather do,
Rob,
is go back to them for a new contract, take as much money as I possibly can, keep it to myself, and then just continue to lord it over you guys. That seems to me to be the best
like
way. That's adulting.
Then you don't got to do the pimple cream ads anymore.
Yeah, I'm pulling back from ads a lot, you know? So, I mean, you know, I'm doing what I can for you people, but I can't make you hungry.
Boy, I got a lot of pimples. I'll take that pimple cream.
Oh, so do I. I don't even work here.
So do I.
You still work here.
Yeah, she works here.
I do, once a month.
No, you don't. You work here. You have a
every
show
week.
Every week.
And every day.
Every week. That's what I meant.
Atlanta Living.
Boy, do I start a tale.
Autumn, who never researches the voices she does. Do I have a show? I thought it was once a year. Huh?
I know that she's on the weekends.
What are you so sensitive
around
about? Joke around with you and you're
it's
all
just
so
another woman in
no,
the office.
No, because you
what
insult
it is
me.
Sensitive.
Because
she's
no,
sensitive.
Because the way that
well,
you
I'm
come
not
at me is insulting.
Tim Andrews. I called him a moron earlier. He understands.
Yeah.
Woo.
Supposed to. We're just busting nets.
Join me at the EDM festival this weekend.
If
EDM you call and order tickets, somebody will answer the phone in 10 seconds.
Wait, Neil, you got the EDM?
Yeah, the salespeople thought I'd be perfect to push these EDM tickets because, Jared was available, but I said, Jared's an idiot. Yeah.
Autumn's a little sensitive because I'm not letting her eat my cake. That's what it is.
Yeah, give me some cake.
No, you can't have cake. You can
give
have
me
money.
Cookies.
Just give her the frosting.
You can have money or you can have cake. You can't have both.
Let them eat cake.
Whoops.
We weren't able to get to that. We got to do it on Monday. It's a couple things. That Chris Matthews thing where he comes in and he's hitting on Autumn.
Hits on me.
And then there's they found a climate, a 19-year-old right-wing climate girl. And
no surprise, she's German.
I just want to hear. I just want to play her.
Yeah,
on Monday, and just hear just something. I don't know if it's. I told Autumn I want you. I want
you
when she play her. I want her to say, "Who is that bitch?" And then I'm wondering, like, is that too harsh? Because the girl's 19, or you know, am I overthinking it?
She's
should
German.
You say? Should you say who is that horrible person? Or, but so just
she's
as,
spreading
just,
lies.
Just discredit. Just say who is that bitch?
Who is that bitch? How could she do this to our movement? And she's one of us.
I'm with you.
And then Britta Trumpberg's upset.
I don't like her.
She never caught up.
You gotta be pretty. I'm not just because I ain't pretty.
Britta, can you wash your hands,
please? Why don't you shut wash your hands?
You've got coal all over your hands.
Keeps away the coronavirus. How dare y'all?
Washing your hands is a waste.
I agree.
A waste of water.
You know what else?
Ingredients in the soap. Gets
Why don't you and I live
water?
In the ocean together?
So yeah, you know, I'll say, but Greta, she's 19. She's part of the youth.
She's a bitch.
She's a Nazi. Back.
She's a Nazi. She can go back to the rock from under which she came.
What was I thinking? Things that she, I think that she would say that she's foul. Who is this foul woman?
Who is this foul piece of garbage?
But we have to be, what I'm saying is we have to be careful because we are talking about a 19-year-old.
Yes, but so I'm also 19, we so would, it's fair.
Other people in the world have called her a right-wing Nazi.
Oh, yeah, because it's okay.
And we're not going to be doing that. We're just going to be having a laugh.
Climate change
skeptic. Germany.
Is this girl, does she go to school? Yes, she
does. Does she go to school?
I rest my case.
I'm starting high school.
No, you're going to go back and get your GED.
That's right. I'll go to community college up there in West Virginia. I go get my GED.
I just think it's funny to hear Greta Thunberg say, who is that bitch?
Lying bitch.
Who is this bitch? What a lying bitch.
But my point of view on it is going to be that I don't like it. No, I don't like now that the right wing is, oh, we found our right wing young kid who will say our talking points. Although, this girl seems very rational.
Her eyes are far apart, though, so.
Untrustworthy.
You can't say that about a woman in 2020.
She's not a woman. Yes, she's 19.
No.
Her eyes are really wide. They're almost as wide as mine.
Her eyes do look too far apart.
She don't look normal.
Who is this bitch?
Who is this bitch?
You want me soccer?
Yes, you do it.
It makes me laugh.
I don't condone it, but I want you to
we'll
do it.
We'll fight later. Let's just knock out this pretty one.
Oh, you say in the this
pretty. Don't make me take off these earrings and my flip-flops.
That's great.
Leave them in.
I don't want to fight a bitch, but I will fight a bitch.
It is on.
It is on. Bring it on, you bitch.
I'll sit on her, you punch her.
You know, we could do some.
Sweep the leg.
We could do some.
I can't kick that eye.
We could do some things.
I do not advocate violence against anybody. I just think it's funny.
For a good cause.
She's a tough one, Greta.
Who is that bitch? I want this. You know what? I'm going to. You know what? I just want this in the clear because I'm then going to figure out how to make it my ringtone. So just in the clear, Greta Thunberg saying, who is that bitch?
Who is that bitch? Who is that bitch?
That's going to be my ringtone.
Who is that
You'll
bitch?
You'll get very tired of it. You'll get tired of it.
I never get tired of
it. He doesn't get enough texts.
Oh, okay.
I came across the end of
bitch.
The day you weren't here, we turned on the I don't know when it usually turns on. We got the whole segment, the last segment of the radio show. When I'm having to put stuff up. And I heard the Greta Thunberg on Wednesday. Was so damn funny. I never listened to this show. I was just laughing so hard. It was just so funny.
Autumn, can you send me a clip of that?
Of what?
Just a short clip of Greta and a couple other your
Well, that's right.
Voices.
If you go to Wednesday's the beginning of the podcast on Wednesday that's in the Facebook part, it starts with that.
Okay.
I can't remember what you were saying. What was it about?
Yeah,
I never
doing?
Remember.
It was. I can't remember what was in the news. But at
I feel
what
like
point?
We, yeah, we
oh, the climate change denier study. That's what it was.
You weren't here.
I wasn't here, but I still sent the stories out. It was that study about kids getting they're affected by climate change.
That like they're having dreams.
Yes, they're having dreams.
And then I talked about the Paul McCartney thing, and I forgot about this line about how it was for the conservation of Piedmont Park and. All of the plastic bottles.
Yes.
And she goes, we use those plastic bottles, what you say, to create that boat that
my vehicle to take me across the Atlantic. I could use those.
No, folks, this is not a repeat. We're just being nostalgic.
Wednesday.
Oh, Wednesday was so cool.
Wednesday morning.
You know what you didn't thank us for today?
What?
It's Employee Appreciation Day, Eric.
Meh.
What are you gonna give us?
Meh.
Come on.
Do you know in Trading Places with
Never
Dan Aykroyd and he's all drunk and he's the
Eating
Santa?
The fish.
Yeah, that thing where
I always
picture Eric in the morning.
I ain't never saw it. Can you believe that? I never saw a trading place.
The Citizen Kane of the Gen X generation.
Well, you ain't never saw a Citizen Kane.
It's a sled.
Fast Times, no.
Spoiler!
Hey!
I only say that because it's way more than that.
Hey! Spoiler alert!
I met Hitler.
The movie only came out in like 1941.
Oh, we have a Japanese coming over. Somebody order sake.
Tim's watching the Paul Lim show from the early 70s.
Oh, God. Charlotte Ray is my sister, and I hate her.
Oh, yeah, he's got the... I like when the president's put on the official windbreaker.
I'm very laid back today, no tie.
He looks like he's doing something in Tennessee, and he's talking about Warren. She should have got out.
My farmers.
All right, bye-bye, kids. Bye-bye. Bye. Bye-bye-bye. And whatnot.